afternoon. Welcome to the City Council budget hearings for FY 2013. We will convene by having a roll call.
Councilor Adams?
Here.
Councilor White?
Yeah. Here.
Councilor Freeman Daniels?
Here.
Councilor LaBarge?
Present.
Councilor Murphy?
Here.
Councilor Stacey?
Here. We have Councilor Spector and Councilor Schwartz both are planning on being here and have notified me that they're going to be a little late, and I believe Councilor Carney is headed this way. So, but we'll get right to it. First up on the agenda is Chief Russ Sinkowitz from the Police Department. Thank you for coming, Russ. Thanks very much. I know you wouldn't.
Pleasure to be here. good evening. It is by 5 minutes. I'll try to be brief. I was advised to do that, but just wanted to touch base on kind of my philosophy about budget building. This is my 19th year doing it. You know, the difficulty is proper business procedures for public safety is to do zero-based budgeting, and that's basically taking the skeleton of your previous year's budgets and building a budget from the bottom up to be accurate as much as you can. And I usually try to do that. But I also know over the years the expectation is there's only going to be X amount of dollars available. So I've learned to save myself that extra exercise of zero-based budgeting and cutting. And I don't. I just start with what's available, and I try to fit it into the dollar amounts that are given. I don't build an excessive budget, an optimal budget, a level services budget, and then complain that I have to cut dramatically and there's dark days ahead because I have to do it. So when I build a budget, this year's directive was the $5,055,745 level funded. It's a difficult pie to fit all the filling in that I need to operate the police department. But I've completed that task, and I think you've seen the narratives that was given to you earlier in the breakdown of the budget, so I won't go over to overall the FY12 activities of note. We had a very productive year, having the availability of federal money for training, which is no longer available to us, $24,000, and I'll talk to you about training in a little bit. But every year, the two overarching considerations while I'm assembling the budget, I rely on two basic tenets. There used to be three, because it seemed to be when I first took over as chief, it was something that would be in passing and the economy would improve. But it goes without saying, every year it's to do more with less, and we have every year. So now it's just an annual expectation. It's not one of the core tenets of trying to build our budgets. One is maintaining our staffing levels as a response-oriented agency so we can continue to deliver a high-quality law enforcement presence as well as a community-oriented resource. And two, always to maintain where possible and develop our professional and technical competence through an aggressive and measured commitment to training at all levels. For number one, we should be growing in numbers as an agency in terms of staffing and the expectations put upon us. But the reality is we have not in almost all the years that I've been here. We've never had that opportunity. You can see with my annual statistics report, which is posted online, and I also suggest you look at our website. It's I've got two great people working on it. It's current. It's got a lot of information on the department, a lot of the projects that we do, and the community outreach that we do. But every year we grow. We have more calls, crimes, complex investigations and responses, but haven't grown the staffing to compensate. The difference between calendar year 2010-2011 was 1,966 calls for a total of 35,784 responses. That's a 6% increase, and we've had similar increases in other years. Our arrests increased, our offense reports, which are all crimes have increased, the UCR crimes, which are the 9 most serious, have increased. For the first year in several, our motor vehicle collisions, personal injury and over 1,000 damage have increased by 20 for a total of 678. We've been on a downward trend for well over a decade, ever since we started our really aggressive traffic enforcement program, where we used to experience about 900 of these accidents a year. So getting them down to 678, 651 last year, 658 the year before is a good accomplishment of my officer's work. And we wrote 5,901 motor vehicle citations last year. Down from 6,300 the year before, but we've been short. We've got 6 people in training now. We lost 2 officers to other departments earlier this year. So we just don't have the personnel out there. The second tenet is the commitment to training at all levels. First of all, we are a very young organization with many inexperienced officers on the street response level. All the training they get at the academy and their 16 weeks in the field training officer program is valuable. We offer a lot of ongoing specialized training to develop them and encourage them. Abraham Maslow talks about if you encourage people, give them training, they feel like they're going to stay there. We hope that works for some of our personnel. We have ever-evolving technology that challenges our research and our current state of knowledge. That's changing all the time. Everyone's seeing it. And that involves a fair amount of technical expertise for not only our specialists but our street people. We come across devices that we can use to recover video evidence or audio evidence or identify a crime in a neighborhood and have the common sense to see which houses have video surveillance that we can later seek the information out of. We have the basic required annual training that in terms of firearms actually doubled our expenses this year. We used to have an annual qualification and then a second refamiliarization. Now the Massachusetts Police Training Council requires two full sets of full qualifications. And when you add in the overtime and the ammunition and whatnot, you're talking in excess of a $10,000 extra expense that I didn't have to cover in last year's budget. And we're also where the buck stops for crime victims, collisions, emotionally disturbed persons, chemically altered persons, and you name it. People call us, we have to answer. We can't not take a call. We can't say it's not our duty. We have to go to everything. So the broad range of training that we have to do, and if you looked at some of our FY12 accomplishments, you'll see the mental health first aid and the crisis intervention team training that we did using a grant from the state DPH. We were the first in the Commonwealth to do that. Other departments are looking at it, and the training council is looking at integrating it in their basic core recruit academy. So the training is ever present. It's disheartening that the annual local law enforcement block grant money that we get is no longer available, so that's a $24,000 hit that is going to take away from some of the regular training that we've done and some of the specialized training. But the challenges ahead for FY13 to meet the level funded goal. there are so many variables. I'll go over some of them, many of which I've been able to plan for, some that still remain to be solved given the unfortunate economic situation. And to look at a level-funded budget mandate and abide by it is very difficult. You'll be probably seeing a request for about $30,000 in extra fuel costs coming across your desk at some point. It's the first time I've come back for extra money in one of my budgets, but if you saw what fuel costs jumped, it's incredible. And even though I expected about a 7% increase in my budget prediction, it was far greater than that. One thing I did try to work with Senator Rosenberg and other folks is this: if you're unaware, we don't pay federal tax on our fuel. We pay a state tax. We have to pay 21 cents a gallon state tax. And there's been a bill at the legislative level for 2 years that's languished and never made it out of committee. For me, for any other city department, for any other municipality, if that bill ever sees the light of day and gets passed, and I was actually emailing Senator Rosenberg last night, and he says it just dies in committee, and he can't understand why. That'd be a tremendous tax or a tremendous relief on everyone's budget. For my fuel budget, that'd be about $7,000 tax that we're not paying the state. So when you think about all the causes that you talk about and how to make an effect at the state level, I would encourage you to pay attention to that and lobby hard your legislators in the future when it comes up again in a transportation bill that's going to be filed for the next fiscal year in the Commonwealth. The difficulty of doing this level funded budget, we had step increases, which are 3% step for officers in their first 8 years. And again, we're a young department, so that had a pretty detrimental impact. On the plus side, we retired some officers at a higher rate of pay, so bringing in officers at a lower rate of pay gave us a little money. But in the end, being over 90% personnel, the only place I can look to find the room to cover these extra costs, and you'll see in the narrative, is that my budget's built around two officer vacancies that we currently have, and we will likely have a third shortly, that I will not be funding in the budget until the beginning of February 2013. Part of the reason for that is that's when the next scheduled Recruit Academy class is, and we don't hire people before we send them to the academy. The other side of that is if I get a good lateral transfer that wants to come work for us, then I'm going to have to meet with the mayor and Sue and say, I've got a good candidate here, what are we going to do? But that $62,000 in savings in FY13 is built into the budget the way I've scheduled out the hiring. But understand, we hire them in February, 22 weeks of academy, 16 weeks of FTO. They're not going to be available for street patrol until after the end of the fiscal year 13, so hopefully we won't lose any more people. We don't have any immediate retirements coming up on the horizon. So we keep, it's almost a revolving door sometimes. Shouldn't say almost, it is. Likewise, I cannot reduce my overtime light item. I've got six officers still in training, so those are people that aren't available for patrol. Three will be completing their field training officer program shortly, and three are just, will be graduating the academy in June. We'll get into that 16-week program, so they won't be filling slots until the fall. And again, repeating, I have a very young patrol force. So some of the overtime we're spending, if you're not aware, generally, we work a shift technically with a lieutenant that's in charge of the station, a sergeant in charge of the street. But vacations, extra time off, things that happen, sicknesses, we revert to one supervisor to supervise about eight or nine people a shift. Very hard for a lieutenant to be in the building and also making sure that the young guy's on the street, and most of them end up on midnights are doing the right thing. So we've methodically looked at schedules to beef up the supervisor. So there's two supervisors on the shifts with a high preponderance of the younger officers to make sure that they get the supervision and guidance they need to, so they learn, first of all, and second of all, so they don't make mistakes. The field training officers serve as kind of an interim function because they're, although their rank doesn't indicate it, they're not different than a patrol officer. They have extra training and mentoring that they do through the FTO program. They also continue that on a street basis for no extra compensation. Other things, we have the FCC narrowband mandate for our radio systems. If you're paying attention, over 4 years, I had a plan to use regular operating budget money to fund a different replacement of the repeaters. Also, which was a $60,000 project, but we never came to capital improvements for any of that money. Additionally, our normal plan is to transition out every 5 years 20% of our portable radios. So by doing that, all the radios that we have currently on hand are narrow-banded capable. But still, it leaves the expense of about $9,000, I believe, in FY13 to have the technicians come in and actually do the reprogramming for it. So that's, again, part of the variables. That animal control officer contract, it's a 3-year contract. She came in $3,300 a year higher for the bid. And again, we're doing $99,000 a year. It's going to be more than that, $3,300 more a year that I've got to figure out ways to do, handle. We're also transitioning from the now extinct Crown Victoria police vehicle to a suitable, more fuel-efficient replacement to meet the special and rigorous needs of police service. These are more expensive vehicles. The Crown Vic was a good price. The replacements are more expensive. We saw that on the horizon, so about 3 years ago, instead of buying new equipment for inside the Crown Vics, the cages, the seats, and whatnot, we knew that eventually they were going to reach their end of life. So we didn't replace those items with new items. We repurposed some older items to save some money. And again, the OOM for the cruisers has been stable and the same for probably 4 years now, at $103,000 for the three cars, which left me with about $16,000 in OOM this year, which I went to the mayor and Sue and explained and asked for permission to use that money to buy ahead the equipment that's going to go into these new vehicles using the tailings in OOM so we can get a head start, not increase my total OOM cost, and still be able to purchase the cruisers and stay within that $103,000. And he consented. I have an email. You forgot. You know, and again, with the process, you know, we're buying only three cruisers a year out of our OOM. We have to go every year to capital improvements for any other vehicle, the supervisor's car or the cars. We will have discussions about trying to build it into the OOM. So I have a regular schedule of, without having to go with my tin cup, to capital improvements for cars, other cars that are necessary, and just build it into the regular budget so we can keep a proper cycle going. But that's yet to be concluded.
No email on that one.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
It's a text. No. And yet, the other things that are still out there that we're keeping our eye on but can't, you know, definitely define. And we have the shakedown crews of the new police facility. It's a deeply, highly technologically rich facility, as we're finding. A lot of the systems that are being put in place, we know they come with a one-year warranty maintenance agreement, but they eventually expire after 12 months. We're trying to extend that out as far as possible so that I don't end up with a maintenance contract for a month. You know, FY13, that could be thousands, will be thousands of dollars. Trying to work through that process. Other items that came up during the process that we've had to fund is the new radio console, cabling, and antennas for the new building. It wasn't in the construction budget. That was
$12,000, Joe? Yep.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was thinking of something else. Which, instead of, again, the transitioning out of our portable radios, we stopped that program this year to free up some money within my regular budget to be able to fund that radio console antenna program. And just this week, once the building's up, I said, let's go in and do a handheld portable test, see if we can get transmissions and reception in the building. None in the cellar. Sketchy on the first floor. Okay on the top floor. Sort of thought that could happen, hoping it didn't, but it did. So now we're in the process of finding a solution that's going to cost about $20,000 to build an in-station, in-building repeater system. And again, I'm looking at my current FY12 money. I know we've been asked to return as much as we can, but it's not in the construction budget. It's something that needs immediate attention, which means there's other purchases that we're going to have to shift aside that I planned on. So when you look at my tailings or my balance in OM, it seems kind of high, but it's purposefully high because I wanted to wait toward the end of the year to see what these expenses would be like that are coming in. And again, a very technologically rich building, a lot of computer outlets, a lot of data ports for phones, et cetera. The switches that we have, the Ethernet switches in our current station are just not adequate or fast enough, not in the construction budget. But although the recommendation, we buy four switches at $16,000 a piece, we're buying two. We're not going to be able to charge every outlet in the building, every phone connection through reserve. It's a $32,000 project, trying to see where the contingency money lies in the construction project, trying to see what I have for tailings in FY12. But again, a necessary piece of the project that wasn't included in the building costs or the soft costs. And there's dozens of other smaller ones that have happened that we've had to buy little things that we needed. Again, I'm not going to come back to you and ask for more money for FY12. I'm going to try to use the money that you trusted me with to do the things that we need to do. The last big question is going to be the completion and the funding of the firing range. With these other different things that pop up, you know, the $200,000 to $300,000 cost is probably not going to be covered in the contingency, we're guessing. That's going to be unfortunate, but again, we always thought we'd build the physical range, we'll put the rooftop unit on using contingency funds, and hopefully in the future we'll find some, you know, pot of gold somewhere to actually fully outfit the range for the training, which would reduce our twice a year now municipal police training council requirement for firearms qualification. So, in closing, I mean, difficult times we're going to do. We've done it before. Let me just say that I and all the personnel, sworn or civilian, who are members of the Northampton Police Department have, by their daily actions, committed to continue to provide the best professional practices and highest quality of police services that has long been enjoyed by the members of this community, and sometimes and often unappreciated. The priority that should be, though, when reviewing funding moving forward, I've touched on it, so let me summarize it. The retention of current police officers and staff, who we have invested tens of thousands of dollars into their hiring and development, and also attracting quality new officers to the department to fill existing and pending vacancies by offering salary step raises and educational incentive benefits that are competitive with and hopefully better than other police departments and law enforcement agencies. This hopefully will stabilize our staffing so we're not always in a revolving door mode of hiring, training, and losing someone to another agency. And that essentially completes my presentation. If there's any particular questions that anyone has.
Councilor Adams.
A few quick questions here. I was looking at the the grant from the Department of Mental Health.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a really good thing. I think it would be great if there was a full-time social worker available 24/7 if possible. But could you just tell us about the training involved with that the grant provides?
I didn't personally attend it. It's really a street-level one. It's 12 hours. The mental health first aid is 12 hours of developing different kind of behavioral analysis cues to make a determination as to what the individuals are doing. And we've always kind of, by virtue of the psychiatric institutions that we've had here and the various different folks that have attracted Northampton, had a seat of the pants way of handling difficult people, emotionally disturbed people on the street than most police departments have always been sensitive to that. But this really goes to refining the kind of diagnosis and learning skills and attributes about how to speak to people in different, whether they're in a bipolar episode or a schizophrenic episode, and get to the core of the problem that they're having and trying not to use arrest as the only solution to what's going on. And we work hand-in-hand with community service options in Florence. I mean, I don't know how many Section 12s we do a day, which are involuntary commitments, but it seems like two or three every day. We're to the point where we are so trusted by the staff, they don't even send a staff member out. If we call up and say, this is the situation, this is what I think is going on, can you fax it to Section 12 to the station? And they go, okay, yep, you got it, and it's done. So it cleans up the time on the call, waiting for CSO to come out, or trying to get someone to go on an ambulance voluntarily to go get a Section 12 evaluation by their staff. We now have the competence level and the trust that is needed to expedite that and to more fairly treat the individuals that find themselves in crisis for different reasons. So you can hopefully diagnose a psychiatric episode or psychological breakdown, an anxiety attack. You took too much of your Depakote, and that's why you're, dozing. Differentiation between heroin and cocaine, which is good for us for enforcement, but it could be misconstrued as a psychiatric episode. And then the big one is the training we do with traumatic brain injuries for returning vets, because we have so many vets at the hospital, soldier on up there, that are TBI victims and PTSD. So someone may seem like they're having a violent episode and meaning to harm someone, but it could be a TBI episode, or it could be a PTSD outbreak. So it helps us refine the officer's skills to be able to make that determination early on.
What sort of a strain will having be two fewer police officers and soon three?
Well, three. It's one less officer on shift. I've got officers out on family medical leave now, coupled with long-term injuries. And my calls go up every year. Our staffing's the same. So it's a constant juggling act by the officers on the street and the sergeants to prioritize the calls. I mean, today's just a nice quiet Wednesday, and we've had five arrests since 10 this morning. All out-of-towners, breaking into cars, it's like plus accidents, plus whatever. Last night, I think we had three accidents within half an hour of each other, one on the bridge, one on Route 9, all involved multiple vehicles, multiple personal injury. Trying to manage that and all the other calls that are going on with six people on duty, I mean, it could be five in the near future. It's not going to be easy, and they'll be working much harder, and they'll be staying later doing their paperwork on overtime.
Now, if you come back to us for that extra $30,000 for fuel, that'll be the first time you've come back to us ever in 19 years?
The only other time was when we were late in receiving a reimbursement from the Ballistic Vest Partnership Program, which is a reimbursement program. And we had to pay the bills for the vests and then wait for the following fiscal year for the reimbursement to come to us, which went back into the general budget. It's the only other time.
The fuel-efficient replacements to the Crown Vicks, will they have escalated response time?
Actually better. We're looking, actually, the decision was made to look at to do the expeditions. The V6 has quicker response time, more space in it. They're much more fuel efficient. I'm sorry, Explorer. You're right.
Explorer.
You did read the memo.
I've never heard fuel efficient in an expedition.
No, you're right. we bought one with a drug forfeiture case through the DEA. A, it's in the detective bureau, and then B, everybody got a chance to look at it. And it's going to work. It's high visibility. It's all-wheel drive. The mileage is far better than a Crown Vic. Joe, you probably could quote exactly what the mileage is.
It's supposed to be about 26 miles.
20s, which is better than the 13 that we're getting out of the V8s, or V6s.
Last question. Magazine subscription, $6,000. Why is there $6,000 worth of magazine subscriptions?
Oh, that covers dues and memberships and all kinds of things, all the different periodicals that we subscribe to, Westlaw, you know, that goes in there. The Muni sheet is kind of, I asked to do this years ago, is to change the line items to be specific to police, like classroom supplies. That's our photo ID budget. But Munis was based on a school-based budget process, and you can't change the fields by department, best as I understood. So the magazine subscriptions is everything that we subscribe to, you know, the law books, the different periodicals for investigatory materials, that, you know.
Thank you.
Counsel LaBarge?
Yeah.
Thank you
for being here. And just two questions I would like to ask you. We do have the school resource officer position, which was reestablished. The service, I think, is at the high school, middle, vocational, right?
Vocational.
Schools.
That's correct.
In the first 2.5 months of the SRO assignment, 85 incidents were handled directly related to the school population. Some incidents included arrests for disturbances, drug and alcohol calls, and bullying. Now, what does this mean, face-to-face and online?
Well, some bullying is face-to-face. You're right with the person. And then other calls we get is there's bullying going on between Facebook or online bullying.
Can you talk about this, the SRO?
Well, again, that was an early report of his activities. He's been very successful in a lot of areas. He's I know the news recently we were talking about Springfield having high police arrests and whatnot. I mean, arrest is our last recourse for activities in the school. The officer works very closely with the administration of the high school, the vocational school, and the middle school to try to resolve situations, you know, bring the kids together, separate them, call the parents, talk to the parents, try to resolve it without law enforcement. But there's some situations where kids just go crazy and he has to, you know, get in a fight with them, call for assistance, and arrest them. I mean, that's the reality. That's the way some of the kids are on campus. So far, it's very early positive results from the administration. The kids seem to like them. You know, there's a lot of good information coming out of his presence there that we wouldn't otherwise have that is beneficial to the kids. You know, finding out about where the weekend 40-person beer bash is going to be in the woods. You know, we don't go and arrest all those kids. We go and break the party up and tell their parents. And they don't get drunk and drive and end up killing themselves. So it's good stuff.
And cross guards.
I didn't mention the $5,000 that I have to increase in my budget for the crossing guard at Ryan Road School. That's an extra $5,000 I've got to figure out.
Yep. No matter where they're placed, they're needed for protection of our children. My question is, which we had a talk, and even with Margie Riddle, about that the positions of cross guards.
Yep.
And you were really hoping to see that taken out of your budget and placed in the school department budget.
Yes.
And why do you feel that way, Sergeant?
Well, I think that, well, the school department schedules their buses. They know when snow days are going to happen. They know their schedule better. We have someone that has spent several hours a week that has to just figure out the scheduling when they're canceled, make the calls that you don't have to come in today because there's a snow emergency. You know, manage it, do the payroll for them. You know, even though they're only a couple hours a day, it's still the same amount of data entry for them. And I feel strongly that it's more appropriately under the umbrella of the school to control their school crossing guards.
And plus the fact is it relieves your department and you less of a headache trying to post these positions and trying to find people to cover them, correct?
That's the recruitment and hiring. You know, one of the difficulties,
right.
One of the reasons we have so many fewer is A, money, B, we can't find the people to do it.
Right, and the school department would have a better access to it because of the parents and the grandparents and knowing people versus then what you would have.
Yeah, I've long said I think under the school umbrella it's probably the more appropriate place. It's easy for school, like Ryan Road, we want an extra crossing guard. I'd like to, but I don't have the money. It's $4,600 a year. And we ended up, we had enough advocates, we said we'd test it. I understand it's successful, but that's still $4,600 that I haven't planned for before out of my budget. You know, so it's easy for the school to ask for something if they're not paying for it. I think there'd be a different management of how many positions there would be available.
I really have it on my mind about that. Mm-hmm. And to me, it makes sense to do that. And I really feel that's where it belongs.
Yeah, we would still train them. We train them in basic traffic safety, traffic control. But they're right there at the schools. The school knows their schedule. They have dedicated staff for their transportation programs. I think it's a much better fit.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Carney, Councilor Adams, and Councilor Tacy.
Okay, just a few, Chief. Just a clarification, is it one patrol officer and one lieutenant I noticed in the vacancy list, or is it more than one patrol officer? And are you seeking to also hold off on the lieutenant?
I'm not sure that it was public that the lieutenant is retiring, but maybe.
No, I'm just looking at the list.
Okay.
It says vacancy lieutenant. It doesn't say name. It says lieutenant vacancy.
Right, but it's funded.
Okay.
It's a vacancy that's funded, and probably doesn't show up in that, but it does in my Excel.
So. Okay. Oh, so where it says when you referred to a few that will not be replaced until February.
Two positions and a third, because we just recently been advised by someone that they were retiring.
Okay.
Yeah, the lieutenant. There is a lieutenant retiring, which means a sergeant will be promoted, which means a patrolman will be promoted, okay, which means that patrolman style will be vacant, plus the one that's already vacant, plus probably the third.
Okay. So that was just a clarification. And then the other question is more one that's related to what you say is the largest concern, which is retention.
Mm-hmm.
So general demographics, I know you've referred to a really young department. What percentage really live locally? I mean, and I know it's just, I don't know, you don't have that off the top of your head, but maybe.
Oh, I do have it off the top of my
head.
We have almost zero applicants from Northampton to take the test, let alone make it through the hiring process.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have over 200 people take the test, and we ended up out of that 200 with probably 22 viable candidates.
So when we have a number of officers that leave, I think you said we lost two this year.
Mm-hmm.
I know we can't compete with the state police,
mm-hmm.
but do you find that many of them just go closer to where they live if they're from further down in Hampden County or further up in Franklin?
Well, one did go to Spencer, I believe, which was paying more and had the guaranteed educational incentives, and it was closer to his family. Mm-hmm. And the other one went to Wilbraham, which pays about $3,500 a year more base pay. So it was a good thing for him. And the third earlier this year, although he works as a special force now, he went back to nursing. He went to nursing school at the UMS.
Mm-hmm. And so generally, where does Northampton stand in relation to other, like East Hampton, Amherst, wages-wise?
I hate to comment. We're probably around the median, you know, depending on the size of the department.
So it's not necessarily the sole issue. There may be other reasons.
They always tell me it's multiple issues.
Oh.
You know, sometimes salaries, you know, it's just there's various different things that go on. There's no single overriding one, or we would figure out a way to solve it, believe
right.
me.
Right.
Councilor Adams.
Thank you.
We're on the median? I thought we were below. I was told that for
I
years.
Can't. I don't have that information, so I don't.
All right. One quick question. All the patrol officers are making between 40 and 49,000. I noticed one was 15. Is that a mistake? Is it a full-time FTE?
It's a vacancy.
No.
I think that would be the...
Not the vacancy. There's a name with it. It's...
That's
it is? Okay. Thank you. That's what I was wondering.
Is that one I missed?
It all adds up. It's a typo when I cut and paste.
There's two positions, I think they're listed as student officer in the budget document that are the ones that start in February that are 17,000. Because that's all I budgeted for them. But again, they're only going to be working for February, March, April, May, June part. So, should I mention the staffing numbers? Or There was just a cut. So if you go to the page in the city document, which I don't have in front of me. No, I don't have it. I have it in my folder. The page listing the staffing, police department cover page. Mm-hmm. Your sheet says 6 sergeants, 52 patrol officers. It's actually 7 sergeants, 51 patrol officers. Oh. You can make that correction. And then the revenue, fines and forfeitures, there was a reference, if I can find it, to CMVI fees, and the narrative said criminal motor vehicle infractions. Those are civil motor vehicle infractions.
That's in the revenue section.
Revenue section in the front of the budget, correct. Mm-hmm. So that people would be misled if they think that's all we make with all these OUI fines and stuff. Those are the civil motor vehicle infractions. Penalty of prison fines. That was the one other, but it doesn't matter. Okay.
You all set, Councilor?
I am, thank you.
Councilor Tacey.
Yeah. The block grant money you lost, $24,000.
Mm-hmm.
So what exactly did that impact? Is it, or training. Did you just spread it out?
Training and one docu-cam, one video camera for the cruisers.
Okay. And the you talked about the training cost was doubled for something that was mandated by the state, and I missed it.
The firearms qualification.
Firearms, that happens twice a year now?
Mm-hmm.
And it used to be just once.
One qualification, one familiarization. So now qualification is a full boat, 4 hours of overtime. Contact cover, yeah. Shooters, yeah. And then there's thousands of rounds of ammunition that are gone through on that. So.
And that's brand new for this coming year?
It's a regulation that Mass Chiefs kind of wrinkled their nose at when they said, how can you just write a regulation? It's an unfunded mandate. And they said, well, then you won't have certified police officers. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And along with the 21 cents on the state tax on fuel, you said that seems to die in committee every time?
Yeah, I don't want to keep taking up the fire department's time.
No, I get it.
Senator Rosenberg, so far as I've heard, there's no momentum for this change. It was discussed when we worked on both the municipal relief bills done over the last two sessions. Both times it was rejected by committees that worked on the bills. Early next year, we'll be discussing a finance bill for transportation, which will provide another opportunity for the issue to be considered again.
And the 3 cruisers out of O&M, those aren't anything to do with the parking funds?
Oh, the fund sources, yes, pays for those cars.
Okay.
Plus 7 police officers.
Okay. And the repeater system?
The in-building
system. Can you just explain that a little bit? And I know it's just, is it like the box you buy in your house for your cell phone or
sort of kind of it's a VHF frequency, and we'll have to add the fire department to it as well, because they were in our building doing a tour and they couldn't reach my radio the other day, so they have a similar problem.
Yeah,
so we'll have to add their frequency to it. It's just a repeater. It takes from the cellar, each floor has an antenna.
Yep.
And then there's an in-building repeater that goes to the antennas on the roof. So if you transmit a portable radio, it hits the repeater, it amplifies the signal, sends it out, and hits the other repeater sites.
Okay.
The portables alone can't get out of the building. UMass had a similar problem. Their solution was $120,000,
well,
because they have a more complex radio system.
Which brings to my, the question is, you know, this probably should have been or could have been something that was thought out. Did we anticipated this. Is that correct?
We didn't know if it would happen or not.
You didn't.
Our radios work fine in Cooley Dickinson.
Yeah.
Radios work fine in other large buildings.
Okay.
Without, it was my decision to wait to see.
Yeah, okay.
And go, let's see if it works. It doesn't.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else? I'd just like to add one out that in the larger discussion about budgets, we've heard from a number of groups asserting that the reason that people moved to Northampton for a variety of reasons relative to their department, and it should be pointed out that as you noted, it's often underappreciated. The fact that the safety in this community is a considerable draw to people who choose to move here.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that Another thing you didn't state, and I do recall from years past, was the fact that on any given weekend night, Northampton's population comes close to doubling. The police department that is built essentially, am I wrong on the doubling part, or is it, it's not quite that much, but...
Yeah, well, from what we, you know, around 30,000, it builds about 50,000.
So the pressures are, we have a police department designed and built for a community of 29,000 that, because of our attractiveness to surrounding communities, all the associated problems, as you said, number of visitors decide to empty some people's cars locally, and some of them, and increased pressures and traffic incidents, and all the associated things that come with imbibing. All those things put greater stressors on the police department. Just so let you know that there's one counselor, and I think I speak for all of them, that very much appreciates the work of the PD. So
I totally appreciate that.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, and I also want to thank you, Chief, and all your officers in your department, and especially Ward 6. We really do appreciate everything that you have done for us. I know you were bothered constantly with the situation occurring on Briarwood and affecting four streets, constant meetings with police department coming on the street, and people felt very safe, and I want to thank you for that and your staff.
If there are no more questions, thank you very much.
All good. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you. Joyce is up next. It's the auditor's office. Thank you for coming. Appreciate that.
Oh, thank you for inviting me. I have prepared an outline of the city auditor's responsibilities. It wasn't in the packets that went out. I just found out about coming Monday night, so I mean Monday morning.
This is an overview of the auditor's office. I haven't been here before, so I thought I'd give an overview of what we do, what our responsibilities are.
And I do have some some extra ones. Yeah. And Susan. So if you look at the overview, you can see there are four bolded areas. And the auditor's office has four areas of concentration. Yeah. Accounting and financial reporting, payroll, accounts payable, and procurement. The first component is accounting and financial reporting. The audit office maintains the city's financial records, and our purpose is to ensure the proper procedures and sound business practices are followed in accordance with Mass General Law and Northampton financial policies. The auditor's office monitors all financial activities for accountability and legal compliance. The accounting and financial reporting involves preparing financial reports for state and federal agencies, maintaining a complete set of financial records for all city and school accounts, appropriation, debt, and contracts, maintaining a general ledger, subsidiary ledger, journals for the recording of transactions, and the reconciliation of the cash for the treasurer and collector. The office provides the mayor and the finance director and departments with financial assistance and maintenance of accounts of grants and activities and balances. The next bolded item is payroll. The staff audits and verifies employee payrolls and ensures that records and benefits are current and accurate. The staff enters payroll for 21 departments and verifies hours worked, paid time off, and deductions. In FY11, payrolls totaling $44.7 million. That includes the general fund, enterprise fund, NPS, Smith Volk, and special revenue funds. The staff prepares and processes income tax documentation for W-2s and provides payroll support and training to all departments. The staff maintains files and tracks a variety of personal pay types, including stipends, contractual agreements, longevity, jury duty, and accruals. The third bolded item is accounts payable. The staff audits and verifies all invoices for city departments, NPS, Smith Folk, and enterprise funds, and authorizes payment in accordance with the Mass General laws and the city financial policies. In FY11, the staff processed 31,621 invoices totaling $63.3 million. The staff provides accounts payable supports and training to departments and prepares and process income tax documentations for the 1099s. There are two principal clerks and assistant city auditor who are cross-trained and can process payroll and accounts payable. So if a principal clerk is on vacation or out sick, the assistant city auditor can assist and ensure that the continuity of the payroll and accounts payable systems continue. The fourth bulleted item is procurement. The auditor's office reviews all contracts for the city, NPS, Smith Folk, and the enterprise funds, authorize contracts as to appropriation, and verifies compliance with the Mass General Law and city ordinances. The chief procurement officer is responsible for all purchases of goods, services, and construction. He assists departments in determining the level of procurement, compiling of documentation for bids and requests for proposals, attending bid openings as needed, responds to bidders' questions, and assists in assembling and reviewing the resulting contract. The chief procurement officer trains all departments, including NPS and Smith Volk, in legal and practical consideration of public purchasing to assure that the city purchasing is carried out in a fair, legal, and transparent manner. The staff is cross-trained to monitor contracts expenditures so that contract funds do not exceed the appropriation. In FY12, there are 269 new contracts totaling $9.7 million and 91 open contracts that we're tracking from prior year. The chief procurement officer procures and maintains the city insurance coverages and investigates, collects evidence, and files insurance claims for all auto accidents and property damage claims, and assists, as requested, in investigation of general liability claims. The chief procurement officer also monitors the insurance market to see if there's any new products and ways that can better manage the city's risk. For example, the city saved about $10,000 or 44% on builder's risk policy for the new police facility by having the city purchase the coverage versus going through the general contractor. In the budget book, you'll see that the auditor office has five staff members: the auditor, assistant auditor, procurement officer, and two accounts clerks. And in the operation and maintenance section of the budget, the single largest budget item is for funds for the independent audit, which is required by law. So this is pretty much just an overview of what the office does, the laws we comply with, and what we're responsible for. Joe Cook, the procurement officer, is here tonight, and he and I are available to answer any of your questions.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, thank you, Joyce, for being here.
You're welcome.
I requested, going through my budgets on Sunday, that we've never had your department come here.
And thank you for having me.
You're welcome. I mean, for 15 years, I've never seen your department, and I'm really confused with this department also. I look at so much that's being done in this one office, and having two clerks, and I think what I'm really impressed with hearing right now is you saying the cross training. All right? Mm-hmm. It looks like you have a tremendous amount of work here in that office of what you're handling. My question is, here we have one auditor, one assistant auditor. And then we have our procurement officer who's been with us for a period of time and two account clerks. I have a question of when the procurement officer is on vacation, who does his work for him?
I will do the work. I will answer the questions. If it's a legal matter that I cannot handle, I would talk with the mayor's permission with the city solicitor.
Okay, so you are trained in that position to do?
I have experience in Chapter 30B and in contracts and in procurement. Prior to this, I worked 11 years in Amherst as the assistant to the town manager, and I've been a town administrator and assistant accountant in other Franklin County towns. So over the years, I have the experience that in his absence, I can help the departments with what they need.
I also noticed, Joyce, in one of the paragraphs here, and this is why I'm getting a little confused between the procurement officer plus what you do, and then it's saying that apparently many city employees, you'll provide the training, and it's not saying his position, it's saying that you will go in and assist departments. This is what the language says.
Mm-hmm.
So do you actually go in there? Who goes in there?
For procurement? The chief procurement officer would. The office works as a team, and we would fill in if there's anything that needs to happen. But the chief procurement officer handles the procurement. He does the training. He would compile the documentations needed for a bid or RFP. He attends the bid openings when needed. He handles all the procurement and the insurance procurement also.
And are you also qualified to do that?
I can help departments. I don't have the level of training or expertise that he has, but I can work in procurement and I can help the departments. But I certainly don't have his level of training.
Okay.
In that area.
Do you have to be an attorney to have that level of training?
You don't have to be an attorney, but it certainly benefits the city that he has that background.
Can we recognize the chief procurement officer?
Yes, actually, that's a motion.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor recognize Joe Cook?
Aye.
Aye.
All those. Thank you, Joe.
Hello, everybody.
Do you want to address some of the questions that Council LaBarge is raising?
Right. Typically, if I'm going to be away for an extended period of time, more than a week, I asked Captain Conkus, who's a fully trained, mass-certified public purchasing official certified by the state in public purchasing, to be available for advising departments. I also let the departments know ahead of time, well ahead of time, if I'm going to be away for an extended period so that I can work with them on any purchasing they're going to be doing during my vacation or wherever I'm away. So we can get them done ahead of time, or they can plan to have them done right after I get back. And also I delegate the responsibility to sign contracts, which is something the ordinance only allows me to do. I can delegate that authority to the city solicitor or another city official. So, and it's not required that a chief procurement officer be an attorney. By state law, there is a certification program, a training program, and I have been through that training. And so, but so has Joe Conkus, and now we have been training all the departments. We give regular training. The school department's done a great job of sending their business staff to the Inspector General's training programs. So we've got a fairly high level in the departments of training. And the Inspector General's office also has a free call line for anybody who wants to call in and get some advice about a particular, you know, tough nut to crack with regard to procurement.
No. And I know when there were some changes going on, was there a procurement officer before?
Yes.
Who was that?
Well, I've been here for 25 years, and I've always been the chief procurement officer since Chapter 30B was passed in 1990. I was the purchasing agent.
That's what I thought.
Right. And I also am always available by cell phone if there's a problem. I always give Joyce my cell phone number. She's called me once or twice while I'm on vacation. I've even taken phone calls about a busted windshield in Italy. So it hasn't ever been a problem, me being out of town.
Thank you, Joe.
Any other questions?
That's it.
I have one question that's actually not even budget-related. It's come up recently about bids. A number of people have asked about, for instance, why a Connecticut firm is the firm that's putting in the windows in the city hall. And can you explain why it is that we cannot automatically hire necessarily local contractors for projects of that size?
That is a special situation. That's part of the whole Con Edison $6 million project, and as part of that, they hire their own subs. We don't put that out separately as a bid. But on an ordinary project, we can... we're not allowed to say a Northampton contractor has to get this business or a Northampton business has to supply this equipment. We cannot say that. We've looked into that. There's some language about buying locally for like farm products for a school food program. We can require a Massachusetts or a local farmer get part of the business, but we're not allowed to do that to say just Northampton's got to get this business.
The state law essentially says... Low bid
from a responsible and eligible bidder. So they have the DCAM certification. They've done good projects. You know, they're not shoddy. And I do check out our bidders very carefully because even if they're certified by the state, we found sometimes they're very good at pulling the wool over the eyes of the state. Like on the high school job where we rejected a low bidder and we're darn glad we did. So, you know, we watch that very carefully, but we just simply aren't allowed to say Northampton or Hampshire County for bidders.
Councilor Tacey.
Can explain how in-depth you were in the Con Edison, the contract that we have with Con Ed on the energy?
Well, I was very heavily involved in that from the get-go because it's a... done entirely differently than anything we've ever done before. It's under Chapter 25A of the Mass General Laws instead of the usual Chapter 30B or Chapter 149. It's an RFP process where we look at the qualifications and the suggestions being made by the various companies. So it's a really different process, but we worked with the Department of Energy Resources of the state, gave us a lot of good help. And worked with the Attorney General's office and the Inspector General's office because how this Chapter 25A works with Chapter 149, the usual building statutes and prevailing wage law, was all of a bit of a mystery because it's the first time we've done it. And actually, the City Solicitors Association right now is having a big discussion on their listserv, on their online back and forth about 25A and how all this is supposed to work. So we're able to provide our sample contracts to them. You know, because we're usually on the cutting edge here in Northampton for some odd reason.
I had asked because I tried to read 25A.
It's a difficult.
It's vague to say the least. Yeah.
Yeah.
The whole 25A is a gray area.
Yes, it is.
Okay. And I had one more question, Joyce. On overtime, when overtime is allowed or approved by department heads, there is backup. Is that required by the auditor's office, or is it just required by the department head to keep it?
The department head is responsible. When the timesheet comes through, we only see the total amount of overhead. We don't see the backup documentation. That's what the department head would have.
Okay, so there's no policy in place that quarterly or something like that we would look at that you would see backup documentation. Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you both very much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
And next up is the fire department. I see DC Norris and the chief. So I've been doing a lot of the presentation, and then we open up to questions.
Sounds good. Okay. First of all, I'd like to give you an overview of the FY13 budget and sort of call your attention to this is the first year that fire and EMS are being integrated. So we're going to sort of talk separately about them and then talk in general about the two and how they've been integrated into the budget. In terms of the fire budget, let me give you some highlights. First of all, the fire budget has increased by $130,000. And as you all know, we've repeatedly come before the council for transfers of overtime. And that was because our overtime budget was set as a snow and ice account at about $100,000 a year, when the actual demand, as we trended it over several years, was about $230,000. So in the coming year, our overtime is set at $226,000, a $130,000 increase from where it is this year, and the hope that by using the trend, we can avoid the need for a transfer. And certainly, the mayor and Susan have both encouraged us not only to live within that, but to really try and reduce any and all overtime within that as well. So that translates to the fire budget for the PS side has increased by about 4.6% when you add that $130,000. If you take that out, it's increased by less than 0.5%. So obviously the overtime is driven by several factors, and I'm sure you're sick of me telling you what some of those factors are, but it's driven by injuries, by illness, it's driven by our level of service, the number of people that we have is a minimum staffing level, and last but not least, certainly driven by the number of emergencies. As we look at this year is actually an anomaly that we haven't had large-scale significant emergencies compared to other years. I'm sure you can remember when we had several. So relatively, as we close out fiscal 12, we're in good shape. And as we go into fiscal 13, we should be in good shape because we have trended things to match what the multi-year trend is. This is, in essence, a level-funded budget. So other than the $130,000 increase, that it's a level-funded budget. It produces no layoffs within the fire department, and I'll tell you how we were able to do that. We were able to do that based on two things. One, sort of cost-shifting from our OM budget into PS, so into the personnel services budget. And I have an employee that's retiring next month. That employee will not be replaced until December. That's purposefully, we capture the savings for that to allow us to continue with no layoffs. And by replacing the employee in December, we remain compliant with the Staffing for Adequate Fire and Emergency Response grant that we're in the second year of, or going into the second year of. So let me, that's sort of the sum of the highlights of the fire budget. Let me transition to the EMS budget for a minute, and certainly Deputy Chief Norris will have more specifics on that. But again, this is the year that we're rolling that into, it's really instead of a fire budget, becoming a fire rescue budget. And it's a volume-driven service, so we're projecting out revenues. We're looking at where we are now for call volume and bringing that forward. Overall, it represents a slight decrease based on, one, where our revenue is. Last year it was $2.1 million. This year we're at about $1.7 million, and we're projecting $1.7 for next year. And with that comes a reduction in costs. As volume goes down, cost goes down. As volume goes up, cost goes up. And as well as the stipends for employees go down as the volume and revenue go down as well. So that's why you'll see a decrease in that. let's see. So some of the changes as we transition back to fire, and then I'll turn it over to Deputy Norris to talk about EMS, and we'll sort of conclude with the overall picture. In fire and PS, the large change is certainly the overtime picture. This is the first time that I think we've actually funded based on what we really feel we'll spend in the next fiscal year. Other minor changes are based on trend analysis and forecasting that we've done with Susan, we've done internally. Those things like working out of grade pay, it depends on how many absences we have, and we've forecasted those out, and there have been slight adjustments there. Uniforms are down based on a plateau in new hiring. So if you look at the last few years, the cost of uniforms have really been higher because we've had to outfit several new employees as we took on the role of EMS. And turnout gear is down based upon the fact that everyone except for the chief officer's turnout gear was replaced last year, thus making replacement on a regular basis more unlikely in the next fiscal year. In terms of fire OM, overall, there's a reduction of $12,934. Again, that was shifted toward PS to avoid the potential of any firefighter layoffs. Some of the changes within the budget, though, there are some things that have increased. One is vehicle maintenance. So vehicle maintenance is purposely increased because of the age of the fleet. As I think you all know, for the last several years, we've advocated for a replacement engine. Our fleet is getting older, and we've seen several major repairs this year, including an engine that blew and had to be completely rebuilt. And our ladder truck, the PTO drive, failed. And that was probably, if we sent it out, it would have been about a $15,000 repair. Because we have a very skilled mechanic, we were able to do that for about $3,000. But in general, the trend is, as the fleet ages and as we are financially not able to replace some of those units, we're going to see higher costs in that area. So we've shifted some funds there. You also see a reduction in training for the fire budget alone. And that is very specific based on a couple of things. One, we have an excellent training officer right now, and we're really focusing him to bring programs internally. For example, as I left tonight, I was talking to him. He's on the way to an ethanol training class. Ethanol is becoming a major component in your gasolines, as well as a major component on rail lines and over the road, and it has to be fought differently than standard flammable liquid fires. So instead of us sending several people to that, we're sending one person as a trainer, and he will bring that back to all the shifts. So through the training officer's position, which is extremely valuable, we're focusing internally. And the other things that are developing is online training, both through the National Fire Academy and the Mass Fire Academy, which allows people the opportunity to complete some of the training at their convenience on shift. We have a reduction in tools. It's not that we don't need tools, but we've acquired a lot over the years, and quite frankly, the mechanic told me it was more important to put money into repairs because that's where he sees things going. We've increased the medical expenses. That's the expenses we incur if someone's out injured to match actual trend. So if you look at the past several years, we've put an amount in there, but it's never really been sufficient. This increases it to match the trends that we've seen. And we have an increase in gasoline and diesel. I'm sure you can all imagine why, but if you drive by a gas pump, certainly the volatility of the market affects us as well as the consumers. And in terms of the EMS budget, we're shifting. You will no longer see the quarterly transfers that I know Deputy Chief Norris has come to know and love. He truly enjoys coming here, so if you'd like to invite him, I'm sure he's more than willing to come on your request. But you will no longer see that, in that we're shifting to sort of a posture in anticipation of revenue. With the appropriation of this budget, the EMS budget will be appropriated for the year. Certainly, as I've said, with the rescission of the reserve receipt account, just realize that EMS is volume driven. Right now, we're sort of right at the crest. We're down from where we were last year based on both volume and severity of people that we transport. That produces lower revenue. If that kicks up, our expenses will kick up correspondingly, and we may need to come forward for a transfer. And certainly, if there's catastrophic incidents or a large number of injuries, as there have been in past years, specifically in 1998 when I came to the city, there were, I think, 7 people out injured at that time. So something like that can tip the equation that we would have to come back for a transfer. But I think we're in a much better place, both in terms of fire and EMS, anticipating our expenses. So I'll turn it over to Deputy Norris to go through the EMS budget.
Yeah, with July 1st coming forward and the combination of both the fire and EMS budgets, when you look at it line for line, there's really the 4 line items I want to bring to your attention that we added to the current fire budget are the third-party billing. That line item, again, is we have a third-party billing agent that does all the billing for us. So that expense will go towards them and their costs, which we pay out on a monthly basis. That contract was a 5-year contract that we secured about a year and a half ago, and they get 3.25% of the revenue collected. The other one there is EMS supplies for $50,000. Even though we're combining the two budgets together, we really wanted to at least keep an eye on how much we are using for supplies on these ambulances, so that's why we kind of broke that one out there as well. EMS equipment, that mostly goes towards some of our service contracts. We have service contracts for our cardiac monitors. We have it for our defibrillators. We have service contracts for routine maintenance on the power structures and stair chairs and things like that. And then the last one, the replacement of the units. even though we're combining the two budgets, it doesn't obviously do away with the current debt we have, the debt being the lease in arrears for two of our ambulances. So that $119,000, that is two payments that are scheduled for FY13. So, and again, as the chief mentioned, it's over the years past when I've come before your body and have done the transfers, it's really dependent on the volume, the call volume that we have, and also, as the chief mentioned, the severity. Obviously, the more severe the call, the more equipment and supplies and resources needed to do that call properly. So that's what we're looking at for the combination of the budgets.
Thank you. Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, I would like to recognize Chief Brian Duggan, please.
Well, I think he's already recognized in the presentation, so they're...
Two of them up?
Okay. Yep, two of them up. They're both
we can switch off.
No, that's okay. Brian, many people are questioning and saying that our fire department, okay, has some tremendous high salaries. Could you give me a comparison of other fire departments our size city that their wages are the same?
I think that's a fair statement. I know certainly if you asked our employees, they would say our wages are perhaps a little bit below what others are. And in general, I think when we've done comparative studies through HR, we've either been sort of in the middle or slightly shy of the middle, depending on where we are in relative to contract negotiations. But I think if you compared point by point, you'd find overall, with everything included, that there is a relative comparison to other similar sized cities of our nature. And it varies depending on certification level of people and so forth, but in general, the wages do compare in the middle of the range.
On the overtime, Brian, $376,000, that's the estimate for the year. But is that broken down for the fire department and the ambulance department? Is that combined? That 300?
So it is and it isn't. The fire overtime figure is $226,000 was the original budget figure that should sustain us, and that's based on the trend analysis of we've never been funded. We've always considered it a snow and ice account. I'm sure the council is sick of me appearing and saying we need more money. So this is certainly an attempt to look at trend and say here's what the fire department needs to provide a level of service to the city. Given that we're consolidating the EMS budget in, there's $150,000 of overtime in the EMS budget. That was $165,000 in years past. Chris has been able to work with that, worked it at $150,000, and that's been carried, and those two numbers are then combined into the total budget.
So then it is fire and ambulance.
Fire and ambulance together, right?
Because I know when I called Susan today, I had concerns about that. And that's when she explained to me she thought that it was divided on the overtime. Right?
Yeah, and I will say the combined overtime for fire and EMS in FY10 was 387 and in FY11, 382. So this is right about where the average has been for those 2 years. Combined.
Thank you. And I know also, too, I have a question on here on the comp time buyback.
Yep.
Okay. Is that $17,518? Is there any more that has to be paid out, or is this it?
So that comes from an agreement with the Deputy Fire Chiefs Association, and going back to Mayor Ford, the idea of comp time was, for some employees, several thousand hours at one point. And we've really tried to reduce that. I know Susan and I did a report that shows a declining trend in comp time for the fire department, so we're burning it faster than we're accumulating it. But what that is in the deputy chief's contract, there's the buyback, because if it sits there, it's a future liability to the city, and it's contractually 84 hours up to 100 hours per employee, depending on if they want that or have that amount available. And we've never budgeted that. We've always taken that out at the end of the year. It's either through a transfer or tailings. This is sort of the first time we're actually budgeting it for the future as a contractual obligation. The other thing would be if one of the firefighters hits the Fair Labor Standards maximum for comp time, then anything over that would be bought down, and that varies. Typically, that happened a little bit with paramedic training. I think last year we had either one or two employees that there were some hours that were bought down for that.
As a point of clarification on the comp time issue, the comp time that may be accrued at a lower grade is paid out at the grade that at the higher grade, depending on the length of time for the payout.
Right. And the history was we had some employees with literally several thousand hours of comp time that when they retired, they may have earned it 10 years ago, and now they're paid at a higher wage as they retire. So certainly what we're trying to do is get that down, one, below thresholds that are allowed, and two, to buy that down over time versus paying that at the end.
Councilor Adams.
Thank you.
That's interesting to note that from your studies, from your information, that we're in the middle or just short of the middle as far as the average firefighter salary goes?
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, I haven't done one recently this year, but this goes back to what HR has done as we've compared things in sort of years past for negotiations. I'm sure to get the council the best information would be to redo it based on current figures.
I have a question for the mayor. I asked the chief a similar question about salaries of patrol officers in similar communities, and I was surprised he actually told me he didn't have that information. I was wondering if you would be able to, your office could provide that information, do a study of that sort. Would that be possible?
Yes, and we're actually it's one of the things on my intern's to-do list.
Great.
So we're going to try to do something limited in that regard. Sorry, Joe.
Excellent. Thank you.
One of the issues we're trying to do.
Appreciate that.
And when you respond, please step to the microphone, because Jeremy is going to throw something at my head.
I'm sorry. It's too late now.
It's gone now. Lost it. Any other questions? Councilor Carney.
You clarified the projected decrease in stipends. Is that due to a projected decrease in volume of ambulance service?
We're really building it off of, we're projecting $1.7 million as revenue, and if you keep that out based on the contractual obligation compared to the $2.1 million last year, produced a higher level of stipend versus the $1.7 this year. And what we're seeing as far as trend is, again, the volume's down a little bit, so people are sicker last year, and the sicknesses were more severe. So I think we're projecting sort of a level trend both on volume and the severity.
And is that based on data now from January through May, or how are you coming up with that?
Well, it's based on sort of the current collections to date and projecting those forward. Chris does that on a monthly basis, so I'll let him elaborate.
Yeah. We get the monthly totals from Coastal Medical Billing at the end of each month. And right now, obviously, with 2 months ago, based on the average of the previous months, we're looking at just over $1.7 million in collections for this fiscal year. So obviously, when you compare last fiscal year and this year, lower revenue overall, which equates to lower stipend paid out overall to the members of the body.
Okay. That answers that. And one other question then about, Chief, you reference the training officer now that you have, which is why you have just a hyphen in that line there, because you're hoping to bring in-house a significant amount of training.
Right.
But then we also have the training line, training and seminars at 28.5. So what's the difference between those two categories?
So let's go back a few years to in 2008, the training officer's position was actually done away with because we had a choice of either laying off firefighters or reassigning the training officer to a deputy chief's authority. And that's what we did for 2 years. That's been reinstated for 3 years now. And our training officer is doing a super job. So that allows us to bring more in-house. Actually, the training line item in the fire PS budget was zero both for fiscal 12 and fiscal 13. If we go way back, that was actually sort of a separate account for overtime for training. And over the years, just based on fiscal ability, we weren't able to retain that separately, and that amount was cut out of the budget, and any training comes out of the regular overtime account. So I'm comfortable that we're trending things, that overtime is overtime, whether it's training overtime or whatever. In terms of the OM account, training and seminars, we've taken that from what was the budget of $15,000 for the fireside down to $7,500, and then the EMS portion is added into that to get to the total figure. We've purposely done that based, again, on the availability of more online training, which is really the trend that communities are seeing sort of across the board, and the efforts of the training officer to bring training back. So instead of paying people from each shift to go, we're paying one person to go, and then they bring it back.
Okay, so train the trainer. And one final then.
Sure.
In the SAFER grant, how long have we had that now?
We've had two SAFER grants. One is just ending, and that was a five-year, right?
Yeah.
Five-year. And then we have one that we're now going into the second year of that will end in June of 2013.
Okay, so how many staff are funded out of the SAFER grant, and what portion of their entire cost is covered by the grant?
So the first SAFER grant was awarded to us from the 2007 SAFER grant that paid for partial salaries of two firefighters. It's a five-year de-escalating grant. So in year one, that grant paid for 90% of those two salaries. Year two was 80%. Year three was 50%. Year four was 30%. The fifth year, which we're going to be going into, which ends May 23rd, basically we have to pick up the full cost of those two firefighters. The next SAFER grant we were awarded was in 2011 for $489,000. That was to fully fund the salaries of the four firefighters. It does not cover any overtime costs, so any overtime incurred by those individuals needs to come out of the regular operating budget. And the terms of that grant are we need to pay, we get the funding for those four firefighters for the 2 years, and then the city is obligated to pick up the third year for the cost of those four individuals.
And all of those details are spelled out in the terms of the grant?
Yes, they are.
All right, thank you.
Councilor Tacey and Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Okay. So the mayor's just pointing out on page 59 of your budget book, the SAFER grant contribution is highlighted there, so you can clearly see that.
Thank you. It's right here.
And did I miss a question?
No, not yet.
Okay.
The SAFER grant is not tied to EMS. It's for the fire department, FD.
Right. It basically provides people at a certain staffing level. So, for example, when we have an employee that retires, that trips the grant, and we have to replace that employee within 6 months, which is why we're replacing that employee in December.
Okay. And so I know we've been mixing this, the budgets up, you know, with EMS and fire off and on and personnel back and forth. Do you have a sense of just exactly what the cost is of fire suppression alone for Northampton? I tried to figure that out,
right,
and it was impossible.
I think the realistic answer is it is impossible because our people do dual roles, and you can't just cut it down and say one side is EMS and one side is fire, because if we have a structure fire, all of our paramedics and EMTs are available going to that structure fire as well, allowing us to have more people on the scene. And likewise, our firefighters are going to medical emergencies that are severe or when ambulances aren't available. So there's dual roles that are shared there. I think a very simple answer to that is without the EMS portion, the EMS or the budget was 3.42 million for fire, and that's with EMS separated. When we put them both together, it's 5.2 million.
So,
and I guess there's 21 employees that were being paid for EMS, but again, you can't cut them completely in half because of cross responsibility.
Yeah. Well, I realize that. I know you can't. I was unable to do that with the last three or four budget books that we've got. So we're 1.8 or $1.9 million higher with the EMS over just the fire side.
Right. If we took just fire, level funded it, added the overtime, we'd be at approximately $3.4 million. And we add about another $1.642 million into that by integrating the two budgets together.
Okay, I'll chew on that. Thank you.
Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Thank you. And thank you, Chief and Deputy Norris. Just a couple quick questions. If the level of service for EMS is higher in the upcoming year, we will see Deputy Chief Norris come back to us, right? Because you'll need more allocated to the stipend account, right?
Right.
Okay. So all hope is not lost, right?
No. Just point of clarification for that. This year's stipends and fiscal year 13's budget are based off of this current year's fiscal year's collections. So the number that the projected number we put in this year's budget is based off of this year. So when we put together the budget for FY14, it'll be based off the projections from the collections from next year.
So maybe in 2 years.
So,
yeah. But let's say our call volume goes up by 250 calls in fiscal 13. It's likely that Deputy Chief Norris would be coming in at the end of the year to, there'd be more revenue, also more expense, and to adjust things at the end of the year. The transition is, instead of needing to have the money before we can appropriate it through council, we're now appropriating in advance of sort of receipts. And we're forecasting, but if volume shifts, it's sort of like that shock absorber I talked about, we're going to need to adjust that as well, working with the mayor and the finance director and coming back to council.
Can I ask you to, what effect on would there be any effect on overtime if the minimum staffing level for the fire department goes up from what it is now by one or two?
So, yes, the simple answer is yes to that, that if the staffing level goes up, we have so many people that are hired, we have what's called shift float, where we have people assigned to a shift and we have the minimum staffing level. And if someone's on vacation, it creeps closer. If someone's out sick, it creeps closer. And finally, it gets to that level and we start hiring people in overtime. If the staffing level goes up, we're going to have a lower level of shift float, thus necessitating more hiring situations. So the higher the staffing level goes, the more overtime we're going to have unless we add additional people.
Thank you.
Councilor Tacey.
What is the average firefighter? Have you got an average for the firefighter, what it costs the city in with everything, benefits, everything? Do you have a... I know you probably don't have this on the top of your head.
Yeah. I don't know if Susan would have something like that.
Well, if I poked around a little bit, with about 67 or something thousand dollars, does that sound right?
Susan, could you speak at the mic?
Could we recognize Susan Fright, please?
Yeah, we'll continue the recognition from yesterday. How's that?
Thank you.
Go online, there's a list. We publish it at the end of every fiscal year, yep. The total salaries earned by every employee. So everyone's listed by the total gross for the year. So it lists everything, including their stipends, their overtime, everything. So if you looked at that list for FY11, which I think is on our website, yep. You could look and just isolate fire if you wanted, and then kind of you'd get kind of an average of what people are taking home.
Okay,
I don't have the number.
Yeah, and that's on the website. And I haven't. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'll try and navigate through that website.
And
I'll
let
get that for
ask,
you right now.
Benefits are not in that. So the one thing that wouldn't be there is a benefit cost
right.
of employees, where typically we use an average, and Susan knows better than I.
It's about $12,000 if a person takes a family plan.
Yep.
It's about $12,000 if a person takes a family plan. I'm just repeating that for the folks at home.
Close to the mic.
Yes, close to the mic.
I have to do the math.
Oh, okay.
I have to count up how many firefighters and take the total of the figures and divide it by the number of firefighters.
While she's doing the math, do you have any more questions?
Nope, I'm all set.
Other questions from the floor? If I may, and this is just, again, this is a more holistic view. the trend in fire suppression? Gone up, gone down over the last 10 years?
I think nationwide, the trend of serious fires has gone down based on sprinkler systems, detection systems, and that's very fortunate. If you look at fire deaths, they've gone up and down a little bit, but there is a downward trend based on a lot of the codes and things that have been put in place. So the overall trend is more responses, but less serious responses. But again, we have to be ready for those serious responses, and we have to maintain the ability to do that. And that's quite often where we get into mutual aid situations, either helping another community or another community helping us.
So responses have increased while the severity of the fires have trended downward.
Right.
And then, of course, as far as ambulance responses, of course, we have rather narrow gauge in which to determine that. And so I'm not going to ask you to project that out over time, but the fact that involving EMS services with fire suppression, does it create a larger burden on the department, or as far as man hours work, or is this something that actually there's a, on the cost-benefit analysis, benefits us all?
So I would say our people work very hard, and the volume with EMS included is much higher than it used to be. If you took EMS out of the fire department, I mean, we were faced with sort of the inability to provide the current level of service that we'd have. There was a question of, would Florence Station remain open? I know Councilor Labarge remembers that from several years ago. We've had several discussions on that. What could we staff and what could we push forward as far as resources for just fire suppression? By combining them, the workload has increased, the productivity has increased, and our people work very hard with that. But it also gives us more resources to put in play with situations. So if you look at the national trend is fire-based EMS is growing across the nation. And that this is sort of the way that you're seeing things go is more toward EMS. That EMS years ago used to be 50% of the fire department's volume. Right now, current projections are that it's 70 to 80%.
Thank you. Any other council, please?
Sure.
Can't get it right now.
Are we anticipating ambulance replacement this year?
No.
And when do we... When do you anticipate your next? I want to avoid in the past when it was going to be a year and a half before we were going to replace an ambulance, and then 3 months later a request came before the council for another ambulance, and it was because it was going to be a year or 14 months to order and get the ambulance. So we'd like to have a little advanced notice on that. Yeah. more than 3 months.
So it's been included as part of the capital plan. I'll let Deputy Norris speak about that, but in this fiscal 13, there is no ambulance replacement.
Yeah, right now we have 5 ambulances. All those ambulances have been vetted just like any of the capital projects through the Capital Improvements Committee that is brought forward on an annual basis. And then essentially how we funded them in the past is anytime we need a new ambulance, because the funds weren't readily available, we do the lease in arrears. That's when we come before the body and request those funds. Right now, we're not going to take delivery of an ambulance in FY13. We'll be getting the committee together and looking at taking delivery in FY14 to replace a 2,000 ambulance, year 2,000 ambulance.
So then when would you anticipate ordering or...
Traditionally, they say anywhere from 8 months to 12 months you need to order prior to taking delivery of that.
If prior to taking delivery?
Yes.
Okay, so we would know a year in advance, the council?
I would hope you would anyways through the Capital Improvements Committee. It would have to go through that process.
That's what I'm getting at.
Yep.
So if there's a capital process in fiscal 2014, it would be included in that, and if funded, it would then be ordered. So it would be arriving at the end of fiscal 14 toward the start of fiscal 15. Somewhere in there.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's Brian, exactly what we're looking for with the other engine. And I think it was, what, about 3 months behind the delivery part of it, because apparently there was a problem at one point.
Yeah.
You can recall that.
I think there's a couple of things. One, the chassis changed, that
right.
We've gone to sort of a medium-duty GMC chassis that they no longer make. And if I recall correctly, what we were trying to do is get one of the last ones of those versus trying a new chassis that was really unproven. And now we're seeing some other chassis come on the market that we'll have to evaluate as we go forward.
So you're going to depend on, hopefully, capital plan, correct?
Right.
Or is there any way besides that,
especially
any money?
With the budgets being integrated, there used to be the reserve receipt account where a capital project could be funded through that. Now with the integrated budgets, it's the same as any other capital request in the city. It needs to go forward and it needs to be vetted and be approved by the Capital Planning Committee.
And what would you say the estimated cost would be on a brand new engine? Because I know we paid for the other one and times are changing.
So engine or ambulance?
Engine.
An engine is right now for a custom engine is somewhere around $600,000 to $650,000.
And what about the ambulance?
Ambulance, 225.
Today's dollar, you're looking at $220,000, $225,000, depending on the options that you get for it. One of the ones that the state's looking at now is if refrigeration is needed and things like that. So it's changing. Years prior, you saw the cost increase for these units because of the emission standards changing. So the emissions had to change on these vehicles. So today's dollar, you're looking at least $220,000.
And the suspension or the framework on this on an ambulance, it needs to be 450. Is it the 450 class or above?
No. Right now, out of the five ambulances, we have four GMC 4500s. For the suspensions, they all have air rides on them, except for the older one. And it really is based off of the carrying capacity of those vehicles. Right now, those GMCs are 16,500 gross vehicle weight.
Yep. And does it have to be that heavy? Does it have to be that heavy a truck? Is what I'm getting at. Could we get by with a lesser dollar amount vehicle?
So, I mean, there are choices that the council is going to have to make going forward, and the Capital Planning Committee will have to make. There are smaller van ambulances, but quite frankly, to do the services that we provide and the level of care, providing the larger, heavier ambulance really is essential to give us space to work and to provide that quality of care. So if you drive to the hospital, I'm sure you'd see a mix of sort of the fire service ambulances and then the smaller, lower cost van ambulances. I certainly wouldn't recommend a van ambulance. Similarly with fire trucks, you can, one of the things we're investigating is we've talked about the cost of a custom pumper at $600,000 and over. There's some current activity bidding through the Fire Chiefs Association that may cut that cost for a custom pumper. That's something we're actively looking at. As we get approval, we would look into that. But there's also other options. Just like you can buy a cheaper ambulance, you can buy a cheaper fire truck or buy two for the price of one, but instead of lasting 20 years, it's going to last 10 years. So there's balance and risk issues that the council is going to need to weigh out. I am really a staunch advocate of providing quality equipment for our people to use, and the ambulances are part of that. If you ride in one of ours versus one of the van ambulances, a big difference. And similarly, if you ride in a custom fire truck versus a commercial fire truck, not only is the lifespan, but the working conditions for our people are vastly different.
I didn't mean to go from the box to a van. I'm talking about the truck, the chassis that it sits on. The box is identical on either one. The size inside, everything, even the cubic inches. And they're all set up exactly the same. And, well, and with good reason. Won't get into the reasons why they're all, every compartment is the same and where everything is stored in the same place from one ambulance to another. But the truck that it sits on, I agree, the box is the way to go. Mm-hmm. But do we have to have the big truck? That's my question.
Again, there are choices. There are Ford models out there, and you can see several of the van fronts.
Yep.
But if you remember, we also replaced one of those because it burned up at the hospital one night, and they have chronically had issues where the larger vehicle has tended to hold up better in the longer term.
Okay.
So in terms of value, I think that's what we see.
Good.
Any other questions? Thank you both very much for your time. Appreciate it a lot.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At this point, I should mention that Councilor Carney had to leave. And I also want to mention that we had requested that Kelly Woods from dispatch come, but she was not able to come tonight. So she had wanted to, but she's just not able to. But I think the mayor and Susan can answer some questions relative to dispatch if any councilors have any questions along that line. Doesn't seem to be the case. So,
I'd like to say one thing about dispatch.
Sure.
I called there on several occasions to check for information, things such as that, and they're outstanding. Their records, their information, the stream that you get. I just want to say that I think they do a great job. Thank you.
Well, they've had some considerable challenges this year, and they've met them, and that's
yes, they impressive. Have.
Actually, I would ask the mayor if you describe the discussions relative to combined dispatch with the city of East Hampton. You want to speak to that a little bit?
I can say that we applied with the city of East Hampton for a grant through the state's emergency management agency, working with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission to do a study to look at the feasibility of a combined dispatch service between our two communities, whether it would be feasible, whether it could still operationally could work, and to look at whether there could be economies of scale and savings through that process. So at this point, all we've done is the two communities have met to talk about it. We then approached Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, and then we filed a formal application through the state. The state actually has been trying to create incentives for regionalization, including particularly in this area of dispatch, because it's an area that Massachusetts is somewhat behind the rest of the country in terms of adopting a more regionalized approach. And there's several great examples in other parts of the states where they formed regional dispatches. That sort of was part of a little bit of the genesis for my interest in it. Back in January at the MMA conference, there was a seminar on regionalization, and a couple of my fellow mayors talked about some work that they were doing to try to create regional capacity, particularly for smaller towns or towns that have similar service areas, to be able to create more capacity by sharing those costs. So we're going to study it, and we haven't actually heard back from the state whether we've got the grant, but I'll obviously keep the council apprised on that.
Thank you. Did you have a question?
No, it's just a statement. It's a little bit different level, but we seem to be providing services with Amherst and East Hampton, such as nursing and different things.
Veterans,
yeah. Public health, Board of Health, things such as that. And so it's a trend.
Well, it's
a trend.
Freeman Daniels alluded to it in a meeting last, and in fact, it's kind of ironic with the dismantling of county systems, which is we're going back to regional management of systems, yeah, in the absence of counties, which is I find that somewhat curious. But that's I'll leave that without comment and a crack at Boston.
Or Worcester.
Right now, Planning Office, the Planning Department, Wayne Fiden is here. Step up to the podium.
Are you in town now?
I am in town.
Are you here right now?
Virtually here.
Hologram? This is a PowerPoint presentation? Thank you for coming, Wayne.
What's most useful? Do you want me to just talk about briefly what we do, or
what we've been doing is having a brief presentation with some questions. So So if you're prepared to do a presentation or if you just want to open up to questions.
Sure, I'll do a brief presentation.
Sure.
So I think you all know most of what the planning office does. I just want to run through it quickly because we cover a lot of different areas. We do comprehensive planning. You all saw us last year. We did the open space plan. This year, the Sustainable Northampton Plan is 5 years old, so it's time to go back. The commitment we made when we did that is we come back every 5 years. So that, and those are supposed to be sort of the big picture, working with the community to figure out where we're going, trying to figure out, you know, what's the vision going on. And everything else that we do is really working on implementing the plan. So you see me 10 times a year for an open space acquisition. So the open space acquisitions aren't ad hoc. We do this big 7-year plan, and we come back in between with specific implementation strategies. Likewise, both Sustainable Northampton and the transportation policies that the City Council and Transportation Commission adopted maybe 5 years ago create part of the blueprint for what we do. So we do a lot of work on sustainable transportation. We're doing park and ride lot in Leeds, a lot of the bike paths, obviously, we're working on extending the bike paths, doing work with DPW and a lot of traffic calming activities. And so that area sort of cuts across the board. That's funded both by grant funding and fees that are charged for applicants for major projects as part of the planning board approval. The third area is the jargon is current planning, but this is what you think of as permits. And we really try to, I mean, our goal in life is not to issue permits. That's not why we do issue permits. The goal of a permit system is to implement the long-range plan the city does. So we do a permit system to make sure that applicants are building, following the zoning ordinance that you've all approved and following the comprehensive plan that you all have approved. That said, we've done a lot of work in the last year on looking at, are there opportunities for streamlining our regulatory system? We've been moving towards a single point, single application. So my office administers 18 different permits, and you apply for them all by a single application online on the web, and so that replaced 18 different paper applications. That process has simplified life in having one application. It's still not, frankly, nearly as user-friendly as we'd like it to be. We're moving towards that as quickly as we can with very limited budgets. Other kind of regulatory streamlining we've been doing, again, with your approval, is we've gotten rid of a lot of special permits. Special permits scare applicants because you can come before a board and the board might turn you down. So we've been moving a lot of special permits into site plan approval. The idea is site plan approval still has to go before a board and we work out the details of the project, but there's less involvement on, do I spend $100,000 on permitting, only be turned down. We've done a few other things in terms of expanding Central Business District, which is the district has the least amount of regulations. Obviously, you've all been involved with the King Street process. So a lot of that, those sort of regulatory areas. And then the area which seems to actually take a lot of our time is this generic category of project management. We just do a lot of other projects that are going on out there, which affect economic development and housing and recreation and a whole list of things. So just, you know, a few highlights. We've been working with Recreation on the Florence Fields project. We've brought in, working with them, $1 million in state grants, and then obviously with your approval, about $1.5 million CPA money, and so we're overseeing the construction for that project. We're about a quarter way through the construction there. We have a purchase and sale agreement to buy land behind Lane Construction, which would be working with Lane Construction to build a new business park there, and then the land behind it to become a boathouse. We got through Peter Kokot's office, $100,000 state grant for doing that. So, you know, a lot of the work is those sort of individual projects. Obviously, land acquisitions, you see that.
What was that? I didn't hear that last sentence.
Land acquisitions, the bike path, those are also those project management type pieces. Okay. A lot of smaller grants, you know, we're doing a small project in Leeds for invasive control. It's a state grant for about $10,000 to get rid of invasives.
Councilor LaBarge.
Thank you. Wayne, I know every year I talk to you about this because people have concerns of the city buying open space all the time and losing tax a base here where people could go ahead and sell the property and place houses on it, bringing an income into the city. Can you actually explain the effects on municipal revenue, citywide property values versus effect on city expenditures and the effects on property values in the neighborhood.
Sure.
Could you give me a breakdown on that?
There's a few different ways to look at it. One of the activities I should mention we do is every 10 years we do a detailed analysis because the new census is out. So the numbers I have are a little bit dated, but we'll be updating those this summer on the census. But there's different ways of looking at it. One is in terms of actual revenue to the city. So we've looked at, you know, here's all the properties which are off the tax rolls, if you will, because they're publicly owned parks or recreation or conservation area. And we've run the numbers. I don't remember what they are offhand of in everyone's actual property bill, how much are they paying because that lands in open space. And it's a very small number. I could run it for you again. I haven't done it in a while. But it's the neighborhood of I think, like $20 a year per house. You don't have to look that up. So that's one way of looking at it. So buying land doesn't actually reduce the amount of money that comes into the city because automatically with Prop 2 and a half, in essence, the levy changes. The more important way, though, I think, is are we really affecting land? What's the effect on city costs? And so we've looked very carefully when we buy land at thinking about what's the effect on the city. So we buy land on Turkey Hill Road, for example, and prevent the city from having to extend a road out another half mile, you know, running fire and school buses and police services. We tend to save the city money in services. You know, there's two methodologies out there, both of which are really horrible, that advocates we use. People who think open space is the greatest thing in the world, we use an average cost method. We say, what's the total cost to educate a kid and support a police department and fire station and divide it up by all the properties? And they almost always say we lose money on housing. It's not a very good method because average cost isn't – someone builds a new house. We don't suddenly have to buy a new school teacher or hire a new school teacher or build a new place. So the average cost isn't very good. And so we try to use this method to really more looking at, what's the actual incremental cost for going forward. And so some projects, like the Bean Allard property, part of the project, we created four new building lots. So we brought new property on the tax rolls, and those lots are right along the road. We don't have to extend services. It doesn't really cost us anything. Places like Turkey Hill Road, we'll be having roads that cost us more. And so we look carefully at that. I probably mentioned the example to you of what we hope is the redevelopment of Clark School. Because the reality is people in relatively small units downtown have very few kids, Clark School would all be a profit center for us. And so that's the sort of analysis that we've done of sort of thinking that where do we make money on housing? It tends to be State Hospital, Clark School. Where do we lose money in housing? It tends to be new subdivisions. And so that's part of our detailed piece. We've done, on our website, we've done the numbers in detail for the State Hospital. But each time we buy land, we tend to look at those things as well.
Thank you very much.
Councilor Specter, then Councilor Pacey.
Wayne, how will the federal cuts for rail trails affect either our ongoing commitment to complete the trails, those last little pieces, or how will it affect the operation upkeep and maintenance on the state?
Well, upkeep and maintenance, the federal government has never funded. So, unfortunately, the lack of federal money doesn't affect us because we've always had to absorb those costs. So, federal money has always been up and down. So the Congress at one point in the House introduced bills to get rid of enhancements, get rid of this rail trail funding. As you know, they're now on continuing resolution, so we don't really know what the long term will be. At least so far, what's happening with transportation money is they're not actually cutting the dollars. They are, and this may sound good, they're giving states more discretion. So what's happened in the past is they set aside enhancements, a certain amount of money for enhancements, and they set aside something called CMAQ, Congestion Management and Air Quality. And so these have to be done, these have to be used for good projects. These are everything from bike paths to the boards you put along interstates to make projects quieter. One of the ways they're probably going to be going is rolling those back into overall projects. So a state like Texas can spend all their money in interstates if they want, and if there's local support, the state can continue to pay for bike paths. So I think we're going to see more battles locally. It's not the dollar amounts will change, but more battles between different categories.
And just one more question. What is left in terms of actually capital costs besides the we need some connection over King Street for the bike trails, but what else are you looking at in the future in terms of completing those trails, and how are we going to fund that kind of
thing? So two general categories we're looking at for improvements. The first is we now have this network of trails, is creating more and more access ramps. Because sometimes if you look at a map, some people live very close to a trail, but they can't actually get there. So, you know, as you know, we do have state money right now to build an underpass underneath the railroad tracks,
yes.
Connect the state rail trail with the city rail trail. We have money from Walgreens and the porn shop to do an off-ramp at Walgreens. We're looking at Hebert Avenue. We're looking at a few other places. So we're going to keep adding more and more of those ramps. That's really important. They don't cost that much to provide more access to neighborhoods. We're also looking, all the rail trails we opened, we began the process about that. So we're beginning to think about what would the trails be that won't be cutting the ribbons for the property. And we're looking at two projects in particular. One is going from Damon Road up to Hatfield, right along the Connecticut River, next to the railroad tracks there. And that's, again, a very long-term project. The other is going from the Inhan Rail Trail by the bridge, yep. Over Route 10, all the way to the Line Road Elementary School. Complicated, goes through a lot of different properties. We've done pieces of it. We've already gone from Ice Pond Drive to Florence Road. But that suddenly opens up that whole neighborhood there. The funding for both of them are going to be, you know, federal money's up and down. Small projects are eligible for some recreation grants. Large projects are really going to be based on what happens for highway funding. And I think that's an unknown.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Tacey, and then Councilor.
And the other piece, naturally, to housing, you know, the house, we seem to forget, too, it. There's people that live in that house, and that all becomes customers of different stores, bird store. You build a house, you put people in it, they become customers. That's economy. So housing is not bad. And, housing seems to drive the economy nationwide. So though somebody comes up with a different formula to push our economy forward, housing is the way it is. So it does create a lot. Housing does create a wealth in the economy. Might not be for the city of Northampton, so to speak, but it is. It's a boost for the taxpayers. It's a boost for everybody. It does create economy. It is healthy.
Let me add something to that. It's important. Yeah. One of our goals is, and you see this with some of the zoning changes, but one of our goals is always to make sure that we rezone enough property that there's enough land available for the housing demand that comes here. We don't want, I mean, people are going to want to live where they want to live, but we don't want to force people out of Northampton because the price of land is artificially high.
Right. And a lot of the stuff that we do preserve is stuff that I've liked looking at, like Sylvester Road, the piece we just acquired. I've been driving down that all my life. It's beautiful out there. I mean, it's great. And that's a piece now that will not be developed. And everybody that's been from Northampton or whatever and been down that road for the last 50 years or 100 years has been really on board with that particular purchase.
Councilor Barge and then Councilor Adams.
Thank you. Wasn't it understood anyways with the families that they never wanted that to be any homes being built on that? They always wanted to leave that open space?
Yes, for that property.
Because I remember when we were negotiating with them and so forth, that they had strict rules in the family that they never wanted that developed.
That's correct.
That's all. Wayne, just a question, please. Noticing on your pay for the employees, like we have the land use and conservation planner, Sarah LaValle, at $41,410. Mm-hmm. Some of her pay is coming out of CPA funds.
That's correct.
So if something ever happened to CPA, how would she be funded? How would that extra money be looked at?
Well, if CPA was ever cut, we'd have to reanalyze the position. I mean, we'd lose 2 days of a week with her from that time. Oh. But that's the time that she spends. So she spends about 2 days a week, roughly 2 days a week in CPA, about 1 day a week for Conservation Commission. And so there's each paying for a portion of her salary for it.
And also now looking at your GIS database,
yep.
Position. Now, that's the DPW Enterprise Fund. Which fund?
It's 15% from water and 15% from sewer. And the reason for that is this position creates some of the base data, which is used by every department in the city. So the assessor's maps themselves, the base assessor's maps. Which is sort of the base that everything else in the city builds off of.
So that position at $15,646 comes out of the DPW enterprise funds, which is 50% water.
So half of that is water and half is sewer. That's correct.
And half is sewer.
Right. Okay. Of that 30% of the GIS person. That's
correct. Okay. So looking at your little piece of pie, your total personnel is at 90%, correct? And 10% on operations and maintenance, if you look at that pie, about that?
Councilor Adams, and then Councilor...
Actually, Councilor LaBarge asked my question. It's about the CPA funds paying for salary, but what I was wondering specifically is how is it that CPA funds allow for the payment of salary?
So there's a certain percentage, I believe it's 5%, but I'd have to check to make sure, of CPA that's allowed for administration. And so we charge a bit of the conservation planner, and we have a part-time person as well who supports CPA. So CPA has approved those.
What's that? What's the percentage?
I think it's 5.
Sorry, I didn't hear you. 5%?
I believe that's an right to check to make sure that's allowed. We spend less than we're allowed to spend. So the CPA Act allows a certain percentage, I believe is 5%.
20%. CPA Act allows you 20% of your collected funds, isn't it?
Okay. I have to check. Block grant's 20%.
I know CDBG is.
Okay. Yeah, block grant's 20%. It's a smaller number than block grant. I'm not sure if we spend less than we're allowed to spend.
Yeah, it is.
The idea is really not to have other city agencies subsidizing CPA. You know, this cost of complying with the CPA Act, and so those funds should be paying for those.
Councilor Freeman Daniels, and then Councilor Casey.
Thank you. Mr. Feiden, I want to thank you for all the work you do, and maybe one day we'll get a piece of paper that shows how many funds you've brought into the city through grants and special, you know, winning outside monies and such, because for the $250,000 that your department uses in the city, you have much greater reach and much greater impact. I do have a couple of questions, though. One, what are the groundskeeping supplies?
So this is basically conservation area management. The rule of thumb we use is we buy a lot of land, is that our actual budget for Conservation Commission land management is $1 per acre per year, which obviously doesn't go very far. So we tend to do one or two projects a year. Most of what we do for managing land is done by volunteers. So we use our money sort of, you know, to do those things we have to do. You know, a tree is leaning across someone's house, we have to fix it. So there's some things we have to do for it, and then we use it to leverage other things.
Okay. So why does OPD have to do that? I mean, why isn't that in the DPW budget?
Well, for one thing, we can do it a lot less expensively because we're leveraging both grant money and volunteer time. But the Conservation Commission runs their own land. It's not under DPW.
Can I ask one more question? I'm sorry. Would this budget have included additional, maybe an outside office to staff the Planning Board and Conservation Commission and Zoning Board of Appeals and so on to take minutes and so on? Would this budget ever include that?
Well, we would love to do that. I mean, frankly, what happened at the last recession 10 years ago, we used to have a board secretary who did minutes for our board meetings, and we had to do cutbacks. We lost that position. We've never had it back.
What would that approximately be?
Well, it depends how we did it, but we would probably want to have a secretary that's about half-time. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure exactly what that would be, $20,000 a year type thing. What we did, see, another reason we cut it, Hugh, I mean, it's very difficult for staff to be doing minutes at the same time they're staffing a meeting. On the other hand, there's some efficiencies of the person who knows what they're doing to write the minutes. And so that's the reason we cut it last time. It seemed like it was more efficient to have staff at all the meetings who are doing both. But it's definitely, we can't do as detailed minutes as we'd like to do.
Thank you.
I have Councillor Casey, then Councillor Spector, and then Councillor LaBarge, and I should point out that I just looked up. It's 5% is the admin.
That's all I was going to say.
Okay. So Councillor Spector is out, but the 5% admin allowance for CPA. Councillor Casey, and then Councillor LaBarge.
On the south side of Meadow Street, the community gardens, do we have any more, is there any more financial liability that we have there as a city?
So the city has no liability to them. So I guess there's two answers to it. One is they, like anybody else, are welcome to apply to CPA for funds. And they've applied to CPA for funds. They've been awarded some. There's, I believe, still some balance left in that account.
Yeah.
So there's some money left. And again, I don't follow that well enough, but I know they got a grant. I think there's some money left.
Yeah, but other than CPA money, the city has no financial.
We have no legal obligation. So the deal that we have is the city has a 198-year lease to the property to keep it as community gardens. It's in essence a standby lease. As long as community gardens, as long as Grow Food North Hampton runs the property well and keeps his community gardens, then we don't step in. If they ever failed to do it, the Recreation Commission would have the right to step in and run his community gardens, but they wouldn't have an obligation. So Groveford and Hampton, for whatever reason, 20 years from now, walks away. Recreation Commission could say we're going to take it over, and obviously they could expend money to do that if they had any money, but they're not obligated to do it.
Okay, and the little structure being built out there, what is that?
I don't know the answer to that.
Oh. No, okay.
It's not in the budget.
It's not in the budget. It may be a shed.
I didn't know. I wonder, because I see money keeps continuing getting spent. I just wonder where it was coming from. And I get many questions on my ward because it's in my ward. And
I know they've done fundraising. I know they've gotten CPA money, but I don't know the specific project for doing
it. All right. And one last question. Channel Marker Fund.
Yep.
Can you go over that? And how much are we obligated to spend on and where does the money go? There's administration fees. There's the actual placement of markers and things such as that. Where does the money come from?
Yep.
Where does it go to?
So there's an excise tax on boats that are licensed in Northampton. Whatever you do with your boat doesn't matter, but if it's in Northampton, you pay an excise tax, very similar to, I don't know if any of you own boats, but you probably own cars. And just like cars, when you buy the boat, the excise tax is big, and after 20 years, it's not very big. And so those taxes get collected. 50% of those monies go to the general fund. 50% go into a waterways account. And those funds under state law can only be used to benefit boating. It doesn't have to be motorboats, but we've always put the money aside in channel markers. And so we spend about $3,100, $3,500 a year for doing that. It is a four-town effort, Hadley, South Hadley, Holyoke, and Northampton. Each town allocates some money. Holyoke Gas and Electric, as part of their relicensing, also allocates money, and they're the biggest contributor.
Yeah.
Generally, that's the source of all the money there is. We've had some grants over the years, and the city's money, we pay our own staff time. So Northampton is the lead community. We pay our staff time, so we don't actually spend money for the channel markers. We spend money for staff time, a small amount of staff time, to oversee the project. The other towns in Holyoke spend money to actually go to the channel markers. Generally, that's the entire source of money. This year, because we lost a lot of channel markers with the hurricane,
yeah,
FEMA is reimbursing us 75% of the cost of those lost channel markers. So there'd be a one-time infusion of federal money.
So then we don't actually spend the money on channel markers. We spend it on staff.
Well, all the money comes through us.
Yeah.
So the money that comes from city waterways, we spend on staff. The monies that come from the other towns and Holyoke, we spend on the channel markers.
Now, is that now? So that the staff? Who is the staff?
That's me.
It'd
be me.
So the money that we allocate goes to your salary, and not to the channel markers.
Well, it goes to the staff time for the channel.
Staff time for the channel.
So this again, the commitment.
I get confused because the way I read it, it said it was money was half the money was supposed to be or said channel marker maintenance.
Right. Right.
Okay.
So.
However it happens, I guess it's
the commitment the city made 15 years ago now, when we said we'd be the lead community for the channel marker effort, is we weren't going to subsidize the effort for other communities. We would contribute like every other community does,
yep.
And we would pay our costs out of that process. And obviously it's up and down. You know, last year was more work than usual because we do a three-year, we do an RFP and a three-year contract.
Yep.
This year was a lot more work than usual because we lost a lot of our channel markers. We had to go to bid and replace all those markers. Next year, I'm hoping, will be less work than usual.
So it was like $3,100 or something?
That's our ballpark, yeah, check.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor LaBarge and then Councilor Adams.
What does other intergovernmental mean?
Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. We pay a dues to Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. And so the money comes into the budget, goes out of the budget. PVPC has kept their dues solid, steady for 25 years. So that number never changes in terms of per capita figure. Every 10 years when you get a new census, it goes up or down. It's about 15 cents per person, I believe.
And I want to thank you and your department. And I want to thank all the hard work that has been done in this city. I mean, it's just unbelievable the direction that we're going into. And I want to thank your department.
Thank you.
Good question. You're talking about boats. You're talking about boats docked in Northampton, so is that just Oxbow?
In terms of docks?
Yeah, or I mean boats that are just docked in Northampton, is that how it works?
No, it's actually where you're registered. So if you live in Northampton and store your boat in Long Island, you still pay, if you legally report it, you still pay a tax to Northampton.
Thank you.
Any other questions? I did want to point out that you had stated earlier, Wayne, it's correct that as we acquire land, the revenue to the city is not impacted, but of course there is a greater burden. I just want to clarify, a greater burden is assumed by the taxpayers for offsetting that loss. Didn't want to let that pass without notice. So. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. We're winding up, and I don't know if anyone wants a break, but I would just assume that you're all things being equal, good. Okay, that's for the vote to wrap it up. David Pomerantz, you're come on up. David Pomerantz from Central Services is here. Thank you very much, David, for coming in to talk to us today.
Thank you for the opportunity. Good evening, everybody. What I'd like to do is take a couple of minutes to give you an overview of Central Services fiscal year 13 budget, talk about some of the estimated highlights, things that we're going to be looking to focus on, and I also want to specifically talk about our folding in parking maintenance to Central Services starting, well, we've already started, but officially in fiscal 13. Looking at sort of the 30,000-foot down view, we're going to continue to provide a host of custodial construction, renovations, maintenance, grounds, fire and security services to about 25 facilities across the city, city schools, city facilities, and a portion of DPW facilities. We do a lot of maintenance on NED's facilities, not the operations of the facilities, obviously. One of the key changes between fiscal 12 and fiscal 13, two big changes, is going to be bringing on the new PD. We're going to be moving from a 10,000 square foot facility now to a 30,000 square foot facility, still maintaining a 24/7 facility, obviously, as far as operations. But it's going to present for us a lot of new challenges as far as the maintenance operations and especially the custodial services, and I'll talk more about that in a minute. The other big change for fiscal 13, as I mentioned before, is we're bringing on parking maintenance operations under Central Services. And I'd just like to step back for a second and just note that unofficially, probably for at least three of the last 5 years that I've been here, we have had a good working relationship with parking maintenance staff and have shared resources. My Central Services staff has assisted them over time. Shared equipment as far as getting things done on our side or on the parking maintenance side of the garage or the lots. So this is going to be really a seamless integration. I just wanted to point that out, that it's we already do this. It's a little of a learning curve for me as far as parking and parking funds and how that whole division was put together. But as far as the maintenance operations, it's what we already do. And we're going to be, like I said, seamlessly folding that in to overall Central Services work. Payroll and accounts payable, we're already doing that through my administrative assistant, along with what she already does for the schools, the cities, buildings, Florence Learning Center. So it's just one more layer that we're going to be adding on. So I just wanted to point that out. If you look at the addition of the additional 20,000 square feet, for the new police facility, the 168,000 square feet for the parking garage, the 26,000 square feet of the new parking deck that we're going to bring online probably November and December behind the PD, we're really going to be looking at maintaining just over 1 million square feet of facilities across the city. And that's with a staff of about 54 people. So a lot of work, a lot of space, but we're inching up to that 1 million square foot mark, which for a small city is a lot of facilities. Let me just talk briefly about some key points in the central services budget for fiscal 13, then I want to talk about parking maintenance for a few minutes. If you look at the PS line under central services, you'll see that we're adding 1.5 positions for custodians that are going to be working second shift at the new PD. We now have one person working 7 to 3 on a 10,000 square foot facility, and we're now going to be going to a 30,000 square foot facility. And we ran the numbers as far as labor required for this type of a facility, a 24/7 facility, looked at all the operations we're going to have to do, and we're going to be looking at adding 1.5 people. The 0.5 position is 19 and a half hours a week, so we're just under that other threshold. But we're looking at 2.5 people to maintain that facility on a 24/7 basis. And my maintenance supervisor and I are going to be working out the details of exactly when that second shift is going to start. We have restricted areas, detailed operations that go on certain parts of the building, certain times of the day. And I'm going to be working with Chief Senkowitz as far as clarifying how we're going to make the schedule fit for both our needs and their needs. But that's the main change under the PS lines for central services for fiscal 13. Just noting about the new PD, just like the other 25 facilities we now maintain and oversee in the city, the new PD is going to have a full energy management system capability. We're going to be controlling everything from upstairs and central services. And with the pending gold LEED certification for the new facility, it's an extremely energy efficient building. We've got great projections as far as what the energy use should be based on how the building was designed and built. And again, with our hands on the throttle of the energy management system, it should be a very efficiently operating building once we get over the learning curve, having the building be fully occupied and operational. A couple of notes on utilities on the central services line. We're reaching the end of the construction phase of the performance contract that I've stood here numerous times and talked to you about over the last, it's almost 4 years now. We're going to be meeting recently with, we're meeting soon with Con Ed Solutions, the contractor. We're going to be moving from the construction phase to what's called the measurement verification phase, where the construction crews will disappear and their engineers will now be on site on a regular basis using data loggers, monitoring equipment, as well as their own sort of observations in the field to make sure that what they projected for energy savings across the board, whether electricity, natural gas, water, we're meeting them. And if they're not being met, and we have a discussion about, for example, did I change the occupancy schedule in City Hall to be 24/7? And their model showed, 8:30 to 4:30, or is there something with their equipment and installations that just aren't working properly? And if it's on their side, they get to fix it, and they also get to write that check to the city that I've mentioned to you over time as far as they didn't meet their guaranteed savings. We'll be talking more about that. But between the energy savings we're looking at for electricity, natural gas, and water, and you'll notice there's an oil line still showing on the budget under utilities. That's really disappeared. There were only three buildings left in the city that use oil, two small greenhouses at Smith Folk and the Florence Learning Center. Every other facility in the city is now on natural gas. And we're going to be removing those oil tanks this summer, both above ground and underground. So we're really oil-free in the city now. But between the Con Ed Solutions projections for savings and the fact that we're now going out for electricity and natural gas contracts for the next 18 to 24 months, and we're getting some amazingly low numbers for kilowatt hours and therms because of the market, I think we're going to be doing really, really well as far as energy savings, both units and dollars. And I'm sure that's going to make Susan very happy. Talked about the energy contracts. Streetlights, that's a big one under utilities, and it's one that we've been trying to grapple with for years now. Fortunately, state DPU is about ready to issue a rate tariff for LED streetlights, so it'll be a different rate structure. Chris Mason, the energy officer in my office, is working with a number of communities on a bulk purchase LED program. So we're going to be looking at doing conversions, and hopefully this new rate is going to come into effect sooner than later. But this is the closest we've ever gotten. And once that rate tariff is set, then we can approach National Grid and do some negotiating for LED street lighting and much lower rates. So that's a big step forward for us. One other note, as far as efficiency, I talked about energy efficiencies. I just wanted to note that we'll be continuing the city school trash removal program. I know we're looking at big changes in the landfill this coming fiscal year. We've had a city school trash removal program for years with DUSO. That's continuing as has been historical for the next year. They're guaranteeing that. The bulk purchasing office supplies and custodial supplies program that we set in place a number of years ago with really marked savings. We do a bulk purchase for the cities and the city and school buildings every August. We lock in the prices and the materials, and then it just gets delivered to the buildings over the course of the fiscal year. Big savings there, and this year the DPW is going to be joining the custodial program. So we're going to be looking at additional savings for Ned's buildings as well, as he's going to join the bulk program. A couple of words about parking, then, excuse me, I want to open it up to questions. There are a number of what I'll call backlogged capital improvement projects that were funded, some going back to fiscal 2007, I think, that we're now developing specs to go out to bid for. There's a stair remediation plan, a project rather. There's an elevator repair project. There's some other projects that have been basically sitting on the sidelines. We want to get those implemented and done as soon as we can. The big waterproofing and epoxy ceiling project, that was about $270,000. That's been bid, and work is going to start in that in a couple of weeks. We have the contractor online, so over the course of the spring and the summer, you'll see crews working in the garage, basically ceiling cracks and expansion joint repairs and replacements and epoxy work. That's a big project, and we're just going to be developing additional needs lists of things that need to be done to maintain that structure. Other projects dealing with meter replacements, I mentioned elevator repairs. I'm working with the maintenance staff on updating and revamping their schedules for how their four-person staff is working. The changes we've made so far has already resulted in a reduced number of overtime hours and callbacks. And related to staff having to be called in, I've been talking with the mayor and Susan, especially with the new parking deck coming on, we're going to have to do something about deciding how we're going to use that structure after the court uses it during the day and nights and weekends when it's open for public parking. But we have to do something as far as looking at it more up-to-date or state-of-the-art technology for the card and gate system at the existing garage. It's an aged system. It's got mechanical problems. So I think we should basically be looking at that system as well as the garage, as well as the new deck, and figuring out what do we want to do with that deck. It's 58 additional parking spaces that are available after 4:30 p.m. and all weekends. And parking is obviously an issue in town here. And the last thing I'll talk about with the maintenance staff on parking is that Central Services has used a work order system called ViewWorks for the last 4 years. where all the trades get their work orders from departments and facilities to send them into us. It's a computer-based system, and I'm going to be expanding that to include the maintenance staff for the garage and bring them up to speed on sort of coordinating, scheduling, and prioritizing their work orders for the garage, the parking lots, and their meter program. So we'll be moving in that direction, too. That's basically a nutshell overview. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Councilor Casey first, Councilor Adamson, Councilor LaBarge.
The Desmond Associates layout that we had commissioned, it was a $5,000 report that came out in, I think, 2006, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if we implemented anything in there at this point. So I'm wondering, should we do that report again, or should we just, or are you putting this maintenance plan together? Because it had a detailed mm-hmm. plan on maintenance and what to do each year and how much it was going to cost every year for a period of 5 years.
Right.
Now, go ahead.
I can't answer that right now. I haven't seen the report. The maintenance staff brought over all the files and file cabinets from the parking division, and we've been slowly going through them, and I have not found that report yet. So I want to get a copy of that, and I'll use it as a guide, but I want to also put my own eyes on everything from the parking lots to the meters and hear from the maintenance staff what are their priorities.
Yep.
They're in the field every day. So I sort of want to look at that as a cookbook, and then let's develop a program, you know, for multiple years going forward.
Okay. Because a lot of things are listed in that report. As I go back to the garage and look again, they have deteriorated even more.
Yes.
Joints and things such as that. So I was kind of now the $274,000 total, that includes the repair of these joints and there's a little bit of concrete work and things such as that.
The project was bid as a base bid for the most extensively required work. And that was mostly concrete, spalling,
yep.
and the epoxy joints. And then it was based on the estimated cost to do all the work in the garage that was required. There were five alternates that were put in the bid package as well. And the way it's set up right now, we'll be able to do the base bid and almost three of the five alternates. And the further down the list you go with the alternates, the more cosmetic the work gets.
Yeah.
So we're going to get pretty far in this. Certainly address all the necessary and most critical work.
Because this council, before I was here, had approved that particular portion of the money
mm-hmm.
at one point. Didn't go anywhere, so thank you.
Adams and then Councilor LaBarge.
Why is there $77,000 in postage?
Thank you.
I'm sorry?
$77,000 in postage.
That's what I was.
The whole city.
We have. I forgot to mention that.
Allow David to answer.
Along with the sort of the bulk
that's what I
cooperative programs that we have a mail courier program that does the schools and the city buildings. Okay, so everything the departments send their mail over to us, and we post it. And it's either water and tax and sewer bills. Every once in a while, it's a census report.
What the rec department sends to people and the Elder Vision, for example, those two?
Yes.
Okay, thank
yes.
you.
So basically, it's a postage line that we use to feed the Pitney Bowes machine in the mail center at Memorial Hall.
Thank you.
Makes sense.
What Council of Arts and Council Spectrum, unless you have a...
Yeah, that was my... That was my same question. Was the 70,000?
Councilor Spector.
Well, that's why we're asking.
In the future, are there any plans to try and move some of that mailing, like school things, online, or at least give people like water and sewer bills? As water and sewer moves towards, so the mayor has his hand up.
The mayor.
No, just go ahead.
Oh, you're just...
Wind.
Oh, you're checking the wind. So my question is whether in the future, especially as the city moves towards taking credit cards on some of the tax bills, can't we do away with that kind of mailing? And as more and more people are online, can we do away with some of the school mailings? I know there are a lot less than there used to be, but can we do away with some of those?
And that's really all I can say at this point. It is less. I mean, even Domenico, the mail courier, come in various points and say, you know, we're processing less. It's got to
be. Yeah, it's definitely come in less. And I apologize for that.
You know, forming a group to say, okay, how can we go to the next level and get the clerk and the rec department involved? That's the next step. But it is happening. You're right.
Okay.
So, was there another question? So the transition is to go paperless, and it's also to encourage other departments to take advantage of PDF or regular email mailings and when they're available to reduce costs, I would imagine, associated with
absolutely.
That'd be great to have that consolidated. The mayor would like to say something.
I wanted to just quickly, like I did yesterday with the collector's office, I just wanted to publicly thank Mr. Pomerantz and his entire staff. The changes that occurred in the parking division were sudden, and they were not expected, and he and his staff stepped right in and have assumed those duties even on an interim basis and got projects moving and got some of the needed stuff that had to happen and keep going and kept that going. And I'm really confident moving forward that he and his department will be able to continue to provide, you know, top-notch maintenance services for the parking facilities that we rely on in the city. So I just want to publicly thank him again for taking this on.
Councilor LaBarge, Councilor Freeman Daniels.
And I want to thank David and all his staff for taking in another department, even though you're saying you've been working previously with them, but it's a lot of work, and it's just incredible what your department has been doing, and I want to thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Freeman Daniels.
Thank you. Maybe this is not a question in your department, but are you responsible for some of the rentals that the city has, like the James House?
Yes.
Okay, so I noticed the revenue is completely gone on the James House rental for FY 2013.
Susan, do you want to step up to the microphone and speak?
You're going to have, I think it's actually in the back of the book among the orders, is an order to establish a revolving fund for James House so that we will completely run the James House as its own separate cost center, just like we run now the Florence Community Center, which was given back to the city from the school department. So.
All right, thank you.
Any more questions? Councilor Casey?
I just wanted to say that I had an issue today, and I called Mike Beeman, and he resolved the issue immediately. And as he always has, every time I've called, he or Jason Doyle have been excellent, outstanding. And I just want to thank them very much.
I'll pass that on.
All right.
And David, just a personal note that I have a unique perspective of seeing how the city central services managed years and years ago, and then now seeing it in how it's being run now. And it is exponentially and head and shoulders above whatever we've had before. And that's not necessarily a knock on the people who managed it before, but it speaks more to your abilities and your comprehensive understanding of systems and systems management. So. You are a distinct asset. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you, everybody.
Thanks.
Our councilors, at your pleasure, we can have a discussion or we can split.
I'm splitting.
What's the
just very brief comment, and I'm going to make this again the next council meeting because I feel I need to. I think this budget is very, very good. I have some questions about some of the things in it, and I got a chance to ask it, but this structure. I feel like all the information I need is in front of me. I think that the five-year trend is particularly helpful, as well as having the salaries of departments listed within it rather than just having them online. So I think it's a very, very, very readable, very transparent budget. I thank both of you.
And if you want to speak to that, Mayor, you look like you wanted to speak to that.
I was going to actually just provide one more piece of...
At the microphone, huh?
I was actually, but I don't want to interrupt your discussion, but I was just going to give you one additional piece of information, which was just, I mentioned in my budget address, and it's in the budget, that we were trying to take a look at comp time, and we've done some analysis of comp time, and so... you know, that's now started a discussion about comp time, and I know that some of our news media are looking, are calling me for more information about it. So I put together, Susan helped put together this sheet of just some of the analysis that we looked at. I just wanted you to have this.
Thank
so
you.
So you would understand.
You don't want one?
For the mayor.
When you were putting this together. And
he didn't give you an extra one.
It's a pass.
I'll get one.
Thank you, Mayor.
It's just taking the hours that have been accumulated of anybody who's got more than 40 hours accumulated, because the thinking is 40 hours is something that's manageable that can be worked. Sorry about that. So now David doesn't have one, but we'll get you.
Don't worry about it.
And so basically, you'll just see that we've gone department by department, and you'll see what the balance was 7-1, what the balance was 4-26, the number of employees who are involved, the average number. And you can just see that we highlighted the two, you know, the COA and fire were the two that we decided in this budget. And the chief, I know, spoke about it during his budget presentation. There's that line item for comp time payout there. And then there's a line item in the COA budget for the comp time payout there. So I just wanted to give you some additional data as if there's continued discussion about this issue, so just so that you and the public would understand, you know, how we conducted the analysis and just to look at what's there.
And your intent is to reduce the liability.
Well, and the other thing to keep in mind is as the chief alluded to, it's complicated because we do have different we have a city policy which applies to non-represented people. Then we have different contractual obligations. So in the fire department, they have a different cap on their comp time, which has contractual markers built in for what it needs to, like he described, the deputy chiefs having to pay down some of it. The police has a different, so there are individually contractually obligated ones, and then there's also sort of overall policies. NAPIA has a 40-hour. So I'm trying to, we're trying to look at this, and we're trying to, you know, comp time in and of itself is not a bad thing. It's a management tool. It's a way of allowing, being able to allow someone to work some extra hours, but not have to pay overtime, but then allow them to, you know, take time off during, you know, the next 4 or 5 or 6 week period to offset that. That's sort of the design of it. I think the concern we had is when we see balances start to grow to a point where it becomes increasingly difficult for someone to be able to work that off, and then that becomes a liability, an unfunded liability, and someone alluded to it. I think you made the point in your questioning of the chief that, you know, you may accrue it now, but 10 years from now,
that's
it's
right.
going to be paid out at your current rate of pay at that point. So that was just sort of the background, and this is something I think when I was acting mayor and Susan was somewhat new to we were both new to the job. I know it's something we talked about in finance committee. People have asked us, what about comp time? And we sort of said, just give us a while to look at it. We were trying to analyze a lot of different things. So I wanted to give you the rationale for why we chose those two. And again, we don't have a lot of resources in this budget, but we did feel it was important to try to take a first step. So that's the background.
Councilor Adams says it.
Just a quick question on this budget. It's the format's slightly different from past years. Is this a template based on another community, or maybe something more similar to when you were the school budget director, or is it something that you just both came up with?
We did look at a number of different communities, and actually, I think we would call this kind of a draft of sorts, because it was what we could put together with all the elements we wanted to have, and I think we'll refine it based on comments we get. But I think we wanted to, I think as a former counselor who served with you, and we appreciated the budgets that she had put together, I think we tried to incorporate that same format, and actually, it actually follows a lot of the munis. You know, you heard Chief Sinkowicz talk about that's a munis line item. We really wanted to really achieve a line item budget, you take the same numbers that departments are actually inputting in munis. So a lot of these lines, we're trying to really give all the lines that are in that munis budget. And then we did try to
I think as we talked about it and we looked at other formats, I think that we were trying to cut, have text, but not so much, because I think people really want to see a budget for the numbers. So I think it's a little bit thinner on text, but I think that's the goal, was to try to really just lay out the numbers, and hopefully the numbers tell the story if you lay them out and provide the detail. So, and then some of the charts that you heard us, that we talked about in the budget forums, we then incorporated into some of the revenue narrative that show those 10-year trends that we talked about in state aid and in taxes and things like that. So I don't know if you want to add anything to...
You have to come to the mic. You know, next year we're hoping for a little more time for proofreading.
Yeah.
You know, it was a first budget. Changing the format from prior years took a lot more time. So next year we're going to have more time. And I think next year what I'd like to see on all the departmental budgets is the prior year. So you've got the history on the big chart for revenues, and you've got the 5-year history for the big chart. But I'd like to, you know, line by line, give you more trends for each individual department. But there just wasn't time to do that this year.
Because we would have had to go back and put all those past years into the same format to then show you multiple years, which would have been like having to do 4 budgets instead of 1. So going forward now, we'll just be able to drop in FY13 and then FY14. And then so as we go forward, you'll start to see the detail over time.
Didn't do that. Why?
Did you do have a question?
Yeah.
Because 2 years ago, when I first got on the council, I'd asked about the comp time issue. And I had asked the former finance director, and he says, well, we don't budget comp time because it's budget neutral. And that never sat with me. I never understood what he meant by budget neutral, because it really, it costs. Sometimes costs.
Well, I think one of the issues is if managed properly, it can be budget neutral. And I think one of the things I'm going to try to work on in conjunction with this pay down is trying to reemphasize, make sure that we're abiding by those contractual and also policy limits that we set, and that we try to keep, because I think if you do keep it at those manageable levels, it doesn't become an unfunded liability, because if you're requiring employees to use it during a certain time period and they pay it off, then there's no cost involved. But it's when you start to get way, you know, up into the hundreds and hundreds of hours that would require taking weeks and weeks and weeks off,
exactly.
then it just starts to accrue. So
thank you.
So I just wanted you to have this, and I just want to clarify that again, this is employees with 40 hours or less are not on this chart. So this chart shows 9,507. There's actually about 1,100 accrued hours, but we really were we wanted to focus on people that were above 40 hours, mm-hmm. which is kind of the benchmark. So.
Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions? I entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Third. What's up? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Thank you all very much.